Walking into Marla Marlowe with a cigarette out of one side of his mouth, a beer in his left paw, and my sunglasses over his eyes. I don't know what I'm going to do about that, I really don't. If you're confused about what the pre-show to the show is, well, this is the pre-show to the show, and the point of it is that you can then subscribe to us by clicking on the bell, and then you will know that we are live. Of course, the logic of this is completely, lacking, really, because if you didn't know that we were live, you wouldn't be with us right now, would you? What? Jandre is on camera and he said he saw a Shivambalani, which of course is an emerald spotted wood dove, going Now the other point of the pre-show, everybody, is for everybody to get into a state of meditated zen. I like to tap my head. I like to tap myself on the sternum. Not the sternum. This isn't the sternum. On the substernal notch. Ah, it makes me feel so calm. So calm. Oh, I feel calm. Do you feel calm, Jandre?
Kind of weirded out,
oh. Sorry about that, everyone. I don't feel quite so calm anymore. Oh. Oh. Oh, there's a lion! We knew they were there. We'd hoped they would still be there. But where are the cubs? Two cubs that were missing. I'm not going to tell you the story of these lions, everyone, because then I shall have to repeat it to those of you who are not watching the pre-show to the show. Instead, we will gently sing a song about lions. I'm going to be iron like a lion in Zion. Wah, 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 wah. I'm going to be iron like a lion in Zion. Wah, wah, iron, lion, Zion. Iron, lion, Zion. You don't know the song, do you, Jandre? I think it was Robert Marley. I think it was Robert Marley's last song, actually. Iron like a lion in Zion. Yes. Where are you going, kitty cat? How strange that you should be walking along the road on a day of such warmth, as opposed to lying under a bushel. Well, it is my fervent wish that you are going to find your cubs. I'm going to be iron like a lion in Zion. Very good, Jandre. I'm going to be iron like a lion in Zion. Iron, lion, Zion. Iron, lion, Zion. Iron, lion, Zion. Iron, lion, Zion. Very nice.
Wonderful.
You can see the lion doesn't like the song Iron, Lion, Zion by Robert Marley. No, Jandre, we are not singing Soft Kitty. Stop it. Stop it, Jandre, or I will drive you through a thorn bush.
That's not very zen of you.
Now, everybody, you're going to see us disappear for exactly 10 seconds, and whereupon you will be assailed with a disclaimer in case we see something gory and disgusting. Gory and disgusting. Shortly. Here we go.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good afternoon, everybody. That is a lion. My name is James Hendry. I think she's going to look for her cubs, and this is Safari Live.
Ready.
fine. Now, everyone, welcome to this end of the safari. My name is James. Like I said, Jean Drey is on camera. Say hello, Jean Drey.
Hello.
There we are. And we are live from the Greater Kruger National Park, 8.5 million acres of contiguous wilderness wonderland. It's wonderful to have you with us. Out on the other vehicle, Byron is being filmed by Brian. That is the very first time I've ever got that correct in one go. And then in the tent, a real treat for us today, Jamie Patterson is being filmed by Wiam Duren Braak. So they're going to be having fun in the tent today. We have got a little schools conference later on, but we'll keep you posted on that. Now, this lioness is from the Nkuhuma Pride. We had an amazing incident this morning. They had killed a buffalo at Sydney's Dam, which is just up the direction that she's heading. Something spooked them, and in other words, gave them a fright. The lions got up and ran, except two of the cubs decided that they were too greedy to leave the kill. And I think she's going back to try and find those two little cubs that were remaining. So we're going to try and follow her. But it does get very, very thick in here. If it gets too thick, we will simply drive around to the dam, which is not far from here. Now, this is also a very good time for me to tell you that we are live, which most of you will know, but if you happen to be a new viewer, hashtag Safari Live is the best way to get hold of us. Questions at wildearth.tv is not too bad either. Carrier pigeons, telephones will not work. Nor will smoke signals or Morse code. Unfortunately, Rebecca, who's directing the show today, is not able to manage with Morse code. What is happening to the youth of today? Right, we're going to follow this lioness through some fairly crackly bush. While we do that, let's go and find out what Byron and Brian are up to this afternoon.
Good afternoon, everyone, and it's a beautiful day, some blue sky, but some clouds around, and I've spotted an ear on a termite mound. Have a look at that. There's a little leopard hiding on top of a termite mound. Isn't that fantastic? My name is Byron, and on camera with me this afternoon is Brian, and as always, the Thumb joining us. Now, I've literally just spotted this little leopard lying on top of the termite mound. I think it may be Shungile, the young female. I'm just going to try and reposition and see if we can get a look at her face. Just having a look around. It is fairly thick around here. Well, there she just sat up. Hang on. Let's see what she does. Look at that. That is wonderful. But you know what? Let me see if I can't get around to the other side of the termite mound. We may have a better view of her face from there. Let's have a look. This is a very pleasant surprise. What a start. James with the lion, and we just managed to find a leopard. Alright, I'm going to go through here, try to work my way back. It's the only little gap that we've got. So while I reposition, James and I are not the only ones out here. Jamie is on bushwalk or in the tent this afternoon. Let's go say hi.
And whilst, what a wonderful start to our sunset safari. Lions with James, leopard with Byron, and me sitting sort of Bond villainesque, wrapped in a snakeskin in the middle of the tent. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon, Viam is on camera with me, and we're going to be showing you all things weird, wonderful, and interesting in this particular tent. We have, as you can see, we have a vast array of skulls behind us, so that's the sort of the death wall. Maybe I shouldn't call it that, or maybe I shouldn't term it that, but it's certainly what it feels like, or a little bit what it feels like. We've got the death wall behind us. We have a microscope in order to examine things in greater detail, and we will be using that a little bit later on. And of course, we have all things weird and wonderful and slightly gross because there's a broken egg that's kind of a bit smelly over there. And I think that was actually my fault, but we won't tell James that. We'll keep that between us, I hope. Right, without any further ado, to my first prop. And some of you may have seen this picture on social media, but it is the most extraordinarily huge snakeskin. And actually, I can't even begin to give you a perspective of just how long it is. It is far longer than I am tall. And it is, in fact, a snakeskin belonging to a black mamba. And it gives us this perfect opportunity. It really is absolutely massive. There is its face, or what's left of its face. And that would have been where the shedding of the skin started. Now, black mambas are very rapid-growing snakes. So in a year, they can reach 2 meters. This snake is nearly 3 meters, so nearly just over 9 feet in terms of length. It is absolutely... I can't even show you. I mean, without... I'm not long enough to actually lift the snake skin up for you. So it is absolutely massive. Now, how did we know? Oh, and actually, let me put a disclaimer to this first of all. Those of you who have had pet snakes, you might be familiar with this. Snake skins are actually longer than the individual snakes themselves and slightly wider. And the reason behind that is every time they shed their skin in order to grow and in order to replace it with healthy skin, obviously the scales... This skin would have been wrapped around the scales. So if you think about it sort of mathematically, that has to sort of peel away from the grooves within a snake skin. So a snake skin is always a little bit larger than it would be, than the actual snake that shed it would be. And a healthy snake sheds it in one piece, which is exactly what this mamba has done. Unfortunately, it lost the tip of its tail. This particular specimen was found in Torchwood by James, one of the amazing Boyatella trackers. He found it and he brought it to us. So it's missing another little half a foot or so. Now, are we going to be examining this in slightly greater detail? We're actually going to be looking at it under the microscope in the not too distant future. But I don't want to tear you away from the big cats for too long. So let's head back over to James.
She's not quite there yet, everybody. She's almost at the dam, and she's being very, very cautious. You see, she keeps stopping, she keeps looking, she hasn't started calling yet, but she's about within the range that she might start calling. I'm going to stay behind her now, so that if she calls forward, she's able to, or the cubs are able to hear her, rather than driving next to her, if you know what I mean. There she is. Now she's looking carefully. Now, I'm going to tell you what gave them a fright this morning. And if you can see her there, she's looking up towards the Sabi Sand Ranger's hut. Now, I think what happened is the two game scouts who were on an anti-poaching patrol came past the kill this morning. And just as an indication of what an apex predator is, or how they react to an apex predator, there you have it. So the game scouts have got to do their patrols. They have to follow up and do what they have to do, and that is inescapably means that they are going to have an effect on the animals every so often. Not very often at all, and it's 99% of the time a very positive effect. But you just saw how with the cubs there, the lions, I don't know if you were watching this morning, but if you were, the lions got up and they took off. They wanted nothing to do with the world's largest and most apex predator. All right, let's head across to Byron. He's managed to find you a very nice surprise.
And now this young female is playing a bit of hide and seek with us at the moment. She's hiding just behind the termite mound. She's moved, repositioned, and she was out in the open. And now she's just moved around to the other side. But I think she was just stretching. These young cubs often do get a bit restless. They don't lie still as much as adults can. So wonderful to see her. We were very lucky to find her this morning. And again this afternoon, not far from where we saw her this morning. But she definitely has been moving around. She actually disappeared this morning. We did a loop around one of the dams and in the drainage lines to see if the female Karula, her mother, was around. But unfortunately, she wasn't. And when we came back, this female had disappeared. So I think she just went south across our boundary and then came back again, which they do. And it's interesting to see these young cubs, Shungile and Hosana, becoming a little bit more independent. They're moving around a lot more. They're exploring. They're not staying close together as much as they used to. So it's interesting to see how these young cubs are starting to grow up very quickly. It really is amazing. The next few months are going to be very interesting for us, viewing these cubs, seeing what they do and where they move. And also, if they start to learn how to hunt, perhaps with something small like mongoose or squirrels or a guinea fowl or Franklin. Often young cubs learn to hunt with little Franklin, try and stalk and catch them. It's a process, and then eventually when they get a bit older, they'll be able to look for decent prey, steenbok, impala, but only from the age of about a year and a half, I would say, on average. And she has got a beautiful little vantage point there at the moment, up on the termite mound. She can glance around and survey the terrain and area around her, and she's also in the shade, which is perfect. As we said earlier, there's a bit of cloud cover, so it's not too hot this afternoon. It's really lovely. And such a nice afternoon. Good to be out again. And just shows you never know what you're going to find. And I'm so glad I broke that little streak that I had, or that day rather, where I just couldn't find anything. And I know Jamie said yesterday she felt like she was having a day like that. It just happens at times. You can drive around, search high and low, and find absolutely nothing. And then all of a sudden, the bush rewards you with something like this beautiful leopard up on a termite mound close to us and fairly easy to find. Having a good look and glancing and making sure we check all these termite mounds, it helps if you understand animal behavior a little bit, and knowing that chances are she could be lying up on a termite mound or in a tree. It is fairly warm, and also leopards do enjoy a vantage point to look around, but it all depends, you know. They could also be right in the thicket hiding or in a drainage line. So it was just a bit of luck, I think, finding her. Or should we say skill, Brian?
Skill all
the way. I've been looking around this area again, and no sign of her sibling Hosana or the mother Karula. I've been not sure where they are. I suspect that Karula left this young female in this area this morning early sometime, and maybe even last night, and went off to potentially hunt. And I'm not sure where the young male is. We heard Franklin alarm calling not too far from this area this morning, down in the drainage line, and we searched through there, but we couldn't see anything. So they could potentially be just south of our boundary. We're right up against our southern boundary, the Gowrie access. So they could be south of the boundary. But who knows? Maybe at some point Karula will return and collect this cub and take her to a kill, hopefully. James had an incredible sighting with this young female the other day when he was on bushwalk. Very, very, I think, special sighting. It is not something that happens very often at all. I know, I think I've experienced it once before, tracking a young male leopard, also a very young, fairly young cub, just over a year old, year and a half old, and we were able to sit and view it on foot, but that is not something that happens often, and also not something I recommend to anybody to try. These are wild leopards, wild animals. Occasionally they feel comfortable and they allow you close to them, but usually the leopard behavior is they will try to run away and move away from you unless they feel threatened, and then you could potentially find yourself in some serious trouble. Leopards very fast, very powerful, and they can cause you serious harm. I'm going to try and reposition the vehicle again and see if I can't get a better view of this young cub on the termite mound. While I do that, let's head back to James and that lioness.
Now, very strange situation has occurred here. She walked straight up to the carcass, everybody. The reason we cut to Byron's there was not only because of Shongile. I'm afraid we did lose a bit of signal. Anyway, so we're not trying to hide anything from you. She walked up to the carcass, chased a couple of vultures off, didn't make any contact calls whatsoever, turned around and came straight back along the path that she's come. Now, I don't know, maybe she was thinking about having something to eat and decided that no, she wouldn't, because it's now the carcass is covered in vulture dung, and maybe they fetched the cubs earlier, I'm not sure. But I am sure that she's heading back towards the rest of the pride, and so that question will shortly be answered. Right, we're going to have to get in behind her here on this wonderful game path. Now, many of you will have heard of a game path. This is a game path here, and you can see it's like a highway. And this highway, I think, was made largely by elephants. And it comes basically from One Eye Pan in Simbambili, straight across this little northern section of Juma, and goes straight to Sydney's Dam. On we go. Now, if you are a new viewer, you might be thinking, good grief, these people are crazy. They're bashing over trees in their car. Well, to a certain extent, you might be correct. But we are quite sensitive about which species we knock over. And also, you will notice, well, you won't notice, but that tree, for example, is going to jump up behind us. It's just like a sort of bendy green twig, if you like. And that may sound like a blatant justification, but I promise you it is true. So we'll just follow her through here. And remember, hashtag SafariLive, questions at wildearth.tv. It would be good to hear from you. Now, when we went live, we were just on the road over there, and we came through this area. And so I don't think she's too far from the rest of the pride. Ephraim left them not too far from here. Ephraim is a guide from one of the other lodges. And just quickly, Gendre, if you don't mind, a wonderful example of my very favourite tree over here, everyone. Manilkara mochisa, the Lofelt milkberry. Gendre, make it look green and pretty. There we are. Wonderful. Gendre loves it when I give him a difficult task, don't you, Gendre? Mm-hmm.
It's not a great favorite.
No, it isn't. Okay, marvelous. Let's carry on. Lions are on the offing. Oh, watch out. Thorns here, everybody. Oh, she's coming up on the main road. And we can try and get next to her, and then hopefully the mystery of where the rest of the pride is and if all the cubs are there will be solved. She came from quite a long way down the road that way, so we'll just give her a bit of space so she can walk on the road. Because, you know, like us, she quite likes to walk on the road. There we are, Gendry. I've got you a nice picture of her. Now, this is the female with that nasty injury behind her left elbow, her left front elbow. But it seems you can see there's a very slight limp there. And she's also obviously one of the mothers, and that's why I thought perhaps she was going to look for the cubs. And I say she's obviously one of the mothers because she's clearly lactating still. Her teats are still very swollen. You can hear a very silent afternoon, 29 degrees Celsius, 84 Fahrenheit. And there's just the odd distant buzz of some cicadas. A ring-necked dove in the background, and a scimitar bull. Right, so let's carry on. I don't think the rest of the pride is far from here, but I didn't see them this morning after we left them. Yeah? Now, I'm afraid, Helena, this is an impossible question for me to answer, but I'll give it a go. You say, do I think... Oh, dear. The door has just come open, everyone. I wonder who left it open. Whoever they are will die a very painful death very shortly. Okay. Come on, Gendry. I don't think it was Gendry. There we are. That's it. Okay. Right, something to add to the pre-drive check. Are all the doors shut? Now, Helena, you said, do I think this is one of the mothers, or do I think it's one of the aunts of those cubs that were there? I don't know. I didn't notice until the cubs were, at least until the pride was quite a long way from the kill, which cubs they were. And so it's impossible for me to say if they were the same age, if it was just one of hers, or perhaps both of hers. But I suspect quite strongly, Helena, that one of them at least will have been hers. So I think it's unlikely, but I don't say this with any sense of conviction. I think it's unlikely that she would have gone looking for a cub that wasn't hers. So I don't know that an aunt would have gone to look for two cubs that weren't directly sort of related to her. Well, I mean, of course, you are directly related to your aunt, but not quite as closely as you are to your mother. Now, she was at that tree when we first saw her. That's where we went live. And she's walking at a very sedate lion pace, you see. I'm always interested by the fact that lions and leopards are happy to walk on roads. Lions more so, hyenas as well, but cheetahs will not walk on roads. And because they're right at the bottom of the sort of predator hierarchy out here, they tend to stay in cover. So if you find a cheetah next to a road, you'll find them walking sort of 10 meters in, 30 feet or so, just walking gently along. And they don't walk out onto the road very often, except to maybe cross the road. One day we'll do this in electric vehicles. And it'll be as silent as it is now. You can see, I don't know if you noticed that, see her ears, watch her ears carefully. She's not familiar with being followed by a totally silent vehicle. That's why she's listening. She's completely used to being followed by a vehicle that's on and making a slight engine hum. I think that's quite cool. Let's start the engine again and see if she doesn't just put her leg ears forward. No, maybe my theory is utter nonsense. Certainly won't be the first time, and nor, unfortunately, will it be the last. Now, it's going to get a little bit hairy in here, I think. You know, she has not eaten a lot of that buffalo. She's not looking particularly rotund at all. And so, I don't know, I think she was going to look for those cubs. But she gave up very smartly, I must say. Now, there's some very nasty drainage lines in here. Oh, she's coming this way. Let's let her get past. A brief look at Gendry there. wondering why it is he still hasn't had a haircut. Let's just listen to see if she calls. She's not saying anything, and her footfall is almost completely and utterly silent. All right, well, while we try and sort of figure our way through this fairly thick bush, let's head back across to Pajamas Patterson there in the tent and find out what of the astonishing array of artifacts and things she has there she wishes to tell you about now.
And that, of course, is the joy of the tent, is the astonishing array of artifacts. And we'll get onto some of them in a little bit, because, of course, some of them are entirely relevant to what it is you're seeing, the apex predator with James, with the lion, and, of course, the leopard with Byron. So we'll go into in a little bit more depth. We'll go into the skulls and what we have here in order to show you, because, of course, most of you will know I've been dying to get my hands on these skulls and examine them closely. I've played around with them a few times. But before we do, speaking of apex predators, because I did want to talk about this particular snakeskin in slightly more depth, because I learned something about mambas, and I would like to share that particular piece of knowledge with you, because of course when the snakeskin first arrived, there was much debate as to what snake it was. It's very difficult to tell the shape of the head when it looks like this. It's slightly spread out, and it is very tricky to come to an accurate conclusion unless you do what's known as scale counting. So individual species of snakes have different scale patterns, and that's one of the ways that herpetologists go about identifying them. Now, the massive size of this particular snake was pretty much a giveaway, but what I went and did was I got hold of my snake book, and I started looking at the different scales, particularly here on the upper lip. Now that, those scales there are called upper labial scales. And just have a look, if you look closely here, see how they go towards the eye. So they basically meet up around the eye. And then there's a whole little series of scales around them. The other snake that we might have confused this particular one for, although it would have been a record breaker, if in fact it had been one, was a cobra. So there was a discussion about whether or not this was in fact a cobra, and so we had to go and do some really serious research. And what we've got here, and it's not as clear in this book, but just have a look at this. So that is the scale pattern of a black mamba. And the upper labials, particularly the third upper labial, is the one that goes and reaches into the eye. And that is one of the bigger giveaways, because if I show you in a second, let me show you what a mamba's face looks like. Because we tend to think of snakes, well, they're all relatively similar, and you'd actually think that perhaps they were, they'd all have very similar scale patterns. But have a look at the face of the snouted cobra. Do you see how around the eye, those scales are actually broken up, so there's actually almost a ring of scales, and then the upper labials don't meet, they don't go towards the eye. And that is one of the big defining features. The other one is that there is a scale, hold on, I've got to find it, sorry, bear with me a second. There is a scale called the anal shield. Now this is the reproductive opening of the snake, it is also where it defecates from, so this is the opening, the cloaca. Not particularly intact, but have a look at that scale. If you can see that scale, there we go. Those two scales there, just above the opening, the reproductive, the genital opening. That is a paired anal shield. So in other words, it's split into two. In cobras, it is one. So there you go. Just something particularly interesting about the way in which herpetologists will go about identifying a snake. I'm not going to go into the full details because you're going to start sleeping if I do. But essentially it involves scale counting. Ooh, this thing is particularly tricky to wrap around and to handle. It's also very fragile and I'm very scared of breaking it. As to what that stuff is, this black stuff, that I have no idea. It must have been some kind of sort of degradation of the skin itself. I don't necessarily think it means that the black mamba had any kind of a skin disease, but it's interesting. I don't know what it is. Perhaps it tarnished in the sun. Perhaps something was actually eating it. I don't know what goes about. We often find snake skins. I don't know what insects or creatures really go about digesting a snake skin, because of course it is just keratin, so it's not particularly nutritious. One of the things that we're going to do in the future is have a look at the scales under the microscope. We're not going to do that yet because I'm sure you're all anxious to see what's happening with that lioness. Let's have a look.
Well, she's just arrived back here, everybody. There was an enormous greeting ceremony. All the cubs came across here. They were playing with her, and she gave a bit of a sort of a bite here and there, and then they tried to suckle. But unfortunately, it's only 4 cubs. So 2 of them remain away, unfortunately, from the pride. As I say, she didn't make any attempt to call them when she went back there, so I'm really not sure what's happened or why it's happened like this. The other thing to tell you is that the smell here is so unspeakably foul that I am not entirely sure that the remaining hairs on my head will make it through the sighting. Indeed, it might singe my eyebrows clean out of my head at this stage. It is utterly disgusting to the point of being making me want to gag. The reason for that is a pile of tar-like dung just over there. Can you see it, Jandre?
Delicious.
Isn't it lovely? And also, you will hear the buzzing of flies. Now, very, very pleasantly for us, those flies have come up off that pile of tar-like stinking dung, and they are now sitting upon our person. These are the sacrifices we make to make sure that you are entertained by the lions over here. Anyway, I am now very worried about those other cubs, and I think, to my mind, what happened is that she probably decided that the threat that she, or the level of threat she experienced this morning, was too great for her to make her presence known by calling. Now, did she make that cognizant sort of decision? Oof, I don't know. Oh my goodness, look at that. I mean, these creatures are truly foul. Anyway, so that does worry me. I think those cubs are still there. I'm pretty sure you'll find they're in a little drainage line under a bush somewhere. And I think probably the rest of the pride will go back there after dark. And maybe that will just sort of bring them out of hiding, if you like. Now, let's talk a little bit about the smell. Smell is one of my favorite subjects, of course. And many people will say to you, well, how is it that an animal able to smell probably 40 times more sensitively than you and I is able to lie in a place that smells worse than your average sewage farm? Well, the answer to that, everybody, is that it's just how the smell is interpreted. They don't find the smell of their own dung unpleasant, and I think it's probably because they have stomachs that are so powerful in acid and various other digestive juices that even were they to try and eat, or were they to have to ingest some of that dung, they'd probably be okay. It probably wouldn't poison them. I suspect it's probably, in fact, for human beings, more toxic than the venom of a black mamba. Certainly, that's what it feels like as my head starts to swim and my brain starts to melt inside my skull. But the reason dung smells bad to us is that we don't have such a powerful digestive system. If we are to eat dung of, say, a carnivore or a baboon or a warthog or something like that, you'd probably find that we'd get extremely sick. And that's why dung is distastefully smelling to us. Whereas to the lions, with their, foul habits and fairly strong stomachs, well, it just doesn't apply. Whew. Mm. And of course, the fact that the sun has now just come out and is shining on that very fresh piece of lion detritus, well, that doesn't really help. I suspect no grass will grow there for the next 1,500 years. It will be a patch of ground so deeply toxified that 2,000 years from now, archaeologists will wonder if perhaps a meteorite didn't land there. A dung beetle. Now let that be... Ooh, hang on a second. Let's just go back to the lion there, Jandri. She's getting a little bit cross because they're still trying to suckle. Sorry. That dung beetle is an interesting lesson, which I'll tell you about now. These cubs are still trying to suckle. That's a complete waste of time because I don't think that that lion is definitely not lactating. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lionesses. That's interesting. There were only 5 lionesses this morning, weren't there, Jandri? Or did you see 6? Sorry, there are. You make a very valid point there, Jandri. You see, this is why it's nice to be around with Jandri, because he's reminded me, of course, that the pride of lions that we see every single day is, in fact, only 5 lionesses and not 6. How embarrassing. Can we go back to a lion, please? So what I was saying about the cub there is that she's trying to suckle. And of course, they're now getting to the age where suckling is not going to be possible. We said a little while back, we thought that one litter was born in mid-June, one litter was born about 2 weeks after that, and then one in mid-July. I'm not sure that that's right. I think Brent reckoned that the first litter was born on Torchwood sort of towards the end of May, and I think that that's probably correct. So regardless, they're now at weaning age, the oldest ones. The youngest ones, not quite yet. They'll get there eventually in about sort of 4 or 5 weeks' time. But what it means is that milk will start to dry up in these females now. And so although they still definitely love a bit of milk, they're going to wander from female to female, hoping and hoping, and eventually there's going to be none left. And interestingly, there, the lioness that... Ooh, the other story, Jandri, that cub there, that's the one with the floppy ear that Taylor called Flip Flop. That is not an official name before Twitter explodes. It's not an official name. It's just quite an interesting one that she's got that floppy ear, probably from mange. Here we go, attempting to suckle again next to us here. And there, look, that's quite interesting. I don't know if you picked that up. But her teats have definitely sunken in. I don't think she's lactating at all anymore. Listen to him whining. Please, Mum, just a little bit. We didn't finish the buffalo today. I'm so hungry. That's a little lioness, of course. The other thing we must try and do here is to try and sex who's here and who isn't. She's going to get a nasty kick in the face. It's amazing how patient the lionesses have been, but now, no more. Enough of that. Now the others are having a bit of a cross-patch fight the other side. So she's still lactating. She's still lactating a little bit. Let me get the binoculars out and see if I can't identify who's male and who's female. Still so fat with buffalo. At least 2 females there. I think we've got 3 different ages of cubs. I think we've got 2 of the oldest litter, 1 of the middle litter, and 1 of the teddies there. I think that's one of the teddies in front. The teddies, for those of you who don't know, they were the youngest litter, and they just looked like teddy bears to me, so that's what I called them. Yeah, that's Floppy. Flip-flop. Flap-flip. She's a lioness too, so there are definitely two lionesses. All still looking for milk. And interestingly, Jandri, on that one, the closest one to us, she has still got her hips sticking out a little bit. Oh, that's lovely. Isn't that nice? Walk up to your friends and have a wee. Excellent. Oh, and the cub is now in the process of doing exactly the same thing. Wonderful. I suppose it keeps... Oh, there are two of them doing it now. I suppose it keeps the ground cool. Absolutely foul. Gorgeous, really just stunning stuff. This is, of course, why I fail to find lions royal in the slightest. I find them to be, well, just disgusting. I don't think that there's one male amongst these cubs. I think they're all female. Doing their level best to get some food. They are so patient, these lionesses, when they're lactating. Ruth, hello, it's lovely to hear from you. You're in South Africa, it's always nice to hear from home. Not that it isn't nice to hear from away from home. But Ruth, you're wondering, if they stop lactating, will they then go into estrus again? No, they won't. And the reason for that, Ruth, is that once the lactating ceases, it does not preclude the need for them to provide food. So until these cubs are almost 2 years old, they will be almost totally hopeless at trying to look after themselves, at trying to kill things for themselves. Quite unlike leopards, they don't seem to have the same knack. Yes, they'll try and kill small things like squirrels and birds and that sort of thing, but it's highly unlikely that they will manage to kill anything worthwhile before they're about sort of 2 years old. And it's only once the responsibility of looking after them disappears that the lionesses will come back into estrus. So at about 2 to 2.5 years of age for this lot, the lionesses will come into estrus again. So right now, they won't come into estrus until, unless they lose these cubs. And that's looking increasingly unlikely. The Birmingham boys are settled. And of course, well, I mean, look, we've had an incident today where two more cubs seem to have gone missing. Two died of the white muscle disease. The rest seem to have recovered. So it's not impossible that one of these lionesses has lost all her cubs, but I think that there are three age groups here. But I'd be interested to know from anyone else if you agree with me. There are a lot of ticks on these lions as well, and it is amazing to me that they... I mean, their immune systems must be quite something. The rubbish they eat, the ticks they have all over them, the mange, the flies, the all sorts of disgusting bits and pieces of parasites and parasitoids and liver flukes and various other things that they've evolved to cope with is quite astounding. Yeah, I think we're looking at
ticks.
Yes, ticks. I meant, thank you, Jandre. Four little lionesses. I don't think there's one male here. That was delicious. Look at the ticks there. Thank you, Jandre. If everyone wasn't feeling nauseous yet, they certainly will be now. And that is the carpet of lions. Yeah, Liz, you say there's got to be one male left because there were only five female cubs. You're absolutely right, of course. But where are the two that were from this morning? I don't know where those two that have gone missing this morning are. And yeah, there certainly isn't a male amongst these four. unless I've mistaken it, but I'm pretty sure. Yeah, I think these are all females. Would you agree with me, everybody, that we have three ages of cubs here? I think that's what we have. Anyway, it's going to be very interesting to see what happens going forward with this pride, as it is all the time. And of course, this is the great sort of joy of doing what we do here. You follow the lives of these animals every single day, and we just have such a wonderful ebb and flow of emotion. It's triumphant sometimes, it's deeply tragic at other times, it's greatly entertaining sometimes, it can be, well, fairly deathly boring with lions sometimes, but always there's something going on, and there's some kind of a cliffhanger, if you like, at the end of our daily safari soap opera. Right, Jamie is still in the tent. I'm not sure what she's doing. Perhaps she's lit a fire, and perhaps she's about to cook some tea. Let's go and find out.
I have not lit a fire, and I haven't been drinking any tea, although perhaps I've missed an opportunity here. What I have been doing is having a look at the dental structure of the leopard skull that we have. And the reason I've been trying to do that is I've been watching those cubs, and I've been looking at their teeth. And obviously James has been discussing their development and the ages, the fact that we have three different age groups there. And I'm positive about those two missing cubs, by the way. All six of them were there this morning. I have a feeling they're going to be reunited before, if not before the day is out, then certainly before the night is out. But the reason I've been examining this particular leopard skull is, first of all, because I find animal anatomy amazing. But secondly, I'm trying to actually figure out if their dental structure is exactly the same as the lions that are with James. And why can't I slot this together? How can I be this silly? Oh, there we are. I am being silly. Their dental structure does, leopard dental structure is exactly the same as an adult lion. So you've got the three incisors on each side on the top and three incisors at the bottom, so that's a total of 12, unless I can't count. And then, of course, the canines. That's relatively self-explanatory. What I'm trying to figure out is apparently there's a 2-3 molar, premolar split, and then apparently only one molar. So that is one molar on the top and bottom of each side. That is the molar there. And it's interesting to see, because I'm getting the formula from the internet, admittedly, I confess, because I don't have my massive reference book with me that has all of the dental formulas in them. But I can't, on the skull, I can't see where the premolars are unless they're fused. And what I've been trying to figure out is exactly, with the little leopard cubs and with the little lion cubs, I've been trying to find out exactly sort of what the cub milk set of teeth, what their numbers are and which particular teeth they have, and then trying to figure out what they'll get as permanent teeth. Because, of course, by around 9 months old, 9 to 12 months old, they should have all of their permanent teeth. Much like children, that development sometimes takes a little bit longer in some, a little bit of a short period in others. It very much depends. Now, it's just an interesting thought into the difference. This is basically what you're looking at is a leopard skull, but it is basically at least the tooth structure is exactly the same for a lion. And when they're feeding, of course, that shear with the molars and the premolars slicing together. Quite intimidating, isn't it? Absolutely massive canine. A lion skull, of course, would just be roughly double the size. This is probably a female leopard, or maybe a young male, but it was a lion skull would be much, much larger. So there you go. I'm going to try and find out more. I haven't managed to find out about the cub's milk teeth dentition. But obviously, much like humans, I have no doubt there's less milk teeth than there are adult teeth. That makes sense to me. And of course, you were with Shungile and Byron earlier. She had her double canines. So what had actually happened with little Shungile was her permanent canines had grown out and her milk teeth had stayed in. And as a result, she actually had a double set of teeth on her top teeth, on her top canines, which was very sweet. I love that. That was one of my favorite moments with her. I've had some amazing moments with her. Right, we are talking about apex predators, and I'm desperate to get this thing under the microscope just because I'm desperate to play with the microscope. Now, there we go. Let us go through and have a look at what our black mamba looks like underneath the microscope. I have to say, it's sort of relatively nondescript, isn't it? It's actually not all that exciting. You can't see all that much detail. If I shift it ever so slightly, Here we go. There's the smaller scales of the skin towards the back of the head and the neck. So as the scales start to shorten. And a very good question, because we spoke about the molting, and the molting starts from the nose over here, which this would be the nose here. They rub gently against the nose scales, and then it slowly but surely proceeds, and you get the eyes. There's the I'm not as good as James is with this microscope. There's the eye. The eye lifts up, well, the scale around, the protective scale around the eye. You can actually see how that's interesting. That is scratched. You can actually see the scratches on the surface of the eye. It turns milky, and then it peels away, and there's a protective layer underneath it. But Raisa, you want to know, do I have any idea what type of a fluid a snake is secreting while it's shedding? I don't. I honestly don't have any idea. I find the whole practice, the whole process of ichthyosis fascinating. Obviously, because it's something so foreign to us as mammals, we're constantly replacing our cells in the way that we do. But ichthyosis, or the process of molting, I find quite extraordinary. They really are truly magnificently designed animals. The way in which their scales slot together, fit together, protect their skin, they are intriguing to say the least. And of course, the top scales are much, much smaller and closer packed than the bottom scales. And I don't quite know what the I suppose it makes sense, because the bottom is where the snake moves. So just hold on one second. I'm going to flip the snake skin over. Sorry, everybody, bear with me. It's coming back. It's coming back. And there we go. So there's the bottom scales. Same spot, exactly the same spot. It's just different scales and slightly out of focus. There we go. That helps. So you can actually see the top scales through the bottom scales, but the bottom scale is much, much larger. And it does make sense to me that they would be differently designed, because this is the part that the snake will move across on and does most of its motion. And obviously, perhaps there is a reason to why the scales are much larger on the bottom than they are on the top. I don't know. And I don't know, Raisa, what the liquid is. Maybe those of you who have pet snakes, if you can tell me a little bit more about the liquid secretion that the snakes will produce when they molt, because I don't know anything about that. It's actually the first time I've heard of it. Very interesting. And Vanessa and James, you wanted to know about handling the snake and the snake skin, which is, I mentioned earlier, is very fragile. And you wanted to say, wanted to know, does it ever dry out to the point that it can no longer be handled without breaking? Or will the oils on our skin help to keep it sort of lubricated almost, or to stop it from drying out, to stop it from desiccating, I think is perhaps the best word. A lot of dirt on there, actually. And look at the overlap of the scales. Sorry, distraction as I look at that. No, they won't. Our oils won't help to keep it from drying out. It will dry out. And at some point, unless you preserve a snake skin properly, at some point, unfortunately, in this climate, we'll find that the snake skin does have a limited lifespan. It can be quite long. We could be keeping the snake skin for a few months, but it is going to start to fall apart, particularly, of course, if we keep handling it. But we have to keep handling it because it's part of the learning process and it's part of the learning experience. And quite frankly, it is fascinating. I'm going to perhaps do some research about the fluids of black mambas, not obviously the obvious one of the venom. In the meantime, I'm sure you're wondering what's happening with little Shungile. Let's head across to Byron and have a look.
Well, Shungile is resting and she hasn't moved. Very, very comfortable up on the termite mound. And it's still quite warm, so I think that's why she's just resting and waiting, perhaps for her mother to return, Karula, to hopefully have good news about a kill, perhaps, that she's made. So, I've actually repositioned the vehicle now. We're just on the other side of the termite mound from where we were earlier, because she hasn't moved again. She seems very comfortable up there. And it's interesting, a lot of people think leopards generally lie up in trees, and they don't lie up in trees that often. I mean, we have seen them a few times, and if you are fortunate enough to get a leopard in a tree, it is a wonderful sighting. But they do spend a lot more time on the ground, lying in the shade, in thickets, in drainage lines, or up on termite mounds like this. I was saying earlier what a nice vantage point it is for her. She can keep an eye out for any potential threats, and she, every now and then she just lifts her head, looks around, and also she's still constantly very aware of what is moving around her. She will be listening, keeping an ear out for anything that's moving close by. So even though they appear to be asleep, they are still very, very aware and very alert of what is happening around them. We have had such a wonderful view of her this afternoon. I think I might spend a few more minutes with her and then possibly leave her, let her rest, see what else we can potentially find this afternoon. Jessica, you wanted to know, would the termites bite her? Now, Jessica, if that termite mound was active and there were termites moving around, they would most definitely bite her. However, and if you have a look at this termite mound, there's a lot of vegetation growing on, around, and in it. And that is a good sign that the termite mound is no longer active. I don't think this termite mound is active. I think the termites have moved out. And that could be a number of reasons, but one of the main reasons is perhaps the moisture. The ground moisture under the termite mound has dropped the water level. Termites do rely on water. And if the moisture or perhaps the food in the area has decreased, then they most likely would move out of an area. And this termite mound, I don't think, is active anymore. It appears very old, and especially because all these trees that we can see growing on it would have grown after the termite mound was built. So this is a very old termite mound. But the soil is very fertile because of the termites. They use their feces, saliva, a mixture of feces, saliva, and the soil to build these mounds. And that soil is then very fertile. So any seeds that are dropped on there by animals or birds, those seeds germinate fairly quickly, and vegetation grows out there very easily. So this termite mound is not active, and therefore this young leopard would not be fazed or disturbed by any termites. James Duncan, you want to know what types of trees are around her at the moment. So let's start from left to right. The one looks a bit tricky. We'll see. Now, over here on my left, very thick tree, very sharp thorns on it. This is called a buffalo thorn, which is Ziziphus mucronata. And that has very, very sharp thorns on it. There you can see some of them. So that's that tree. And that will start bearing fruit. They do get little fruit that fairly soon. Some of them have got fruit on them already. Tiny little, almost berry-like fruit, but they've got seeds in it that the buffalo thorn bears. Then the next tree, very close to it, right next door to it, a very tall, big tree. That is called an apple leaf, a Phalaenoptera violacea. And that is a wonderful tree too, beautiful tree for shade. And it is also known as the rain tree. In some cultures, they call it the rain tree because young boys, when they would move out in rural areas, they would go and look after cattle in the field, and they would often use these trees for shade and rest under them. But there you get little spittle bugs, and the spittle bugs secrete liquid. What they do is they drain the moisture out of the leaves and out of the tree. They sit on the branches, and then literally as they are drinking the sap and the moisture out of the tree, it passes through the body very quickly, and that spittle bug then drops moisture down, or little drops of liquid. And often people would be sitting under these trees and have these little drops dripping on them, so they would call them the rain tree. They didn't know what was causing it, but those are the spittle bugs. And then, oh dear, what have we got here? This looks like a false marula. That is what this tree is, a false marula. False marula, what is the scientific name of this now? I have hit a blank. I've not seen one of these for a while. I will think about it. I think it may come to me. Don't want anybody to tell me. I'm going to try to think about it. When I run out of ideas completely, then I'll ask for some help. But for the moment, let me think. I do think I'll be able to get the idea for it. And the false marula, from what I've seen in the past, doesn't really bear fruit. So, what is the false marula? I like these quizzes because it makes me think very hard about the scientific names. And it's interesting, and we only use the scientific names because a lot of the trees within Africa have got a number of common names. So somebody might use for example, the buffalo thorn tree, they might call it a buffalo thorn, they might call it a hakenstek, they might call it a blinkblad wagebiki. Those are all Afrikaans terms. So there's often conflict with common names. But if you say it is a Ziziphus mucronata, there's no other name for it. That is its scientific name. So, and that's how we identify the tree. So it's important for us to learn the scientific names, even though we don't necessarily use them. But if people argue, then we can say, well, this is what it is called, end of story. There's no other name for it. What is it? Yeah, and I'm thinking very carefully on this false marula. I want a, you know what? Is it not Lania schweinfurtii? Yes, I got it. Lania schweinfurtii. That is exactly what it is. I've still got it, Brian. Haven't just lost it just yet. Christina, you want to know what are the chances of this cat being bitten by a venomous snake? Now, it's not uncommon. It has happened before. But fortunately, these leopards are very, very fast and very agile. And I actually saw footage the other day, which I couldn't believe. I'd never seen anything like it before. But a female leopard with her cub, not too far from here, they came across a black mamba, which we all know is very venomous, very big, very fast. And this black mamba, it appeared, had bitten a brown snake eagle. And the snake eagle was on the ground, and the leopards were trying to, I think, potentially steal the snake eagle from the mamba. But these leopards actually attacked this black mamba and managed to chase the mamba off. Now, to be honest, I just find that incredible because a mamba is so fast, and these leopards were pawing at it and jumping away every time the mamba would try and try to strike. I have seen leopards a few times feeding on snakes, mainly pythons, big African rock pythons, that they get very large and very fat, so it's actually a good meal. And I've seen leopards feeding on them before, so they are very quick and they are able to kill snakes if they have to. But if a leopard was unlucky and not quick enough, got bitten by a spitting cobra perhaps, or a mamba, that could potentially result in death. So they would have to be very careful, and usually they try and avoid the snakes, especially those venomous ones. But just shows you never know what you're going to see in nature. And Tucker, good afternoon to you. And you, 4 years old, it's so nice having our young viewers watching. And you wanted to know if this beautiful female leopard, Shongile, found her brother, Hosana. So, Tucker, no, we saw the young male yesterday, not too far from here, but they may have met up during the course of the evening, Tucker. So maybe last night they did meet up, and I've got a feeling that this young male is not too far. I think he's around somewhere, but possibly just hiding, maybe down in a drainage line in a thick area, waiting for the female to return to hopefully have good news that there's some food for them. But I'm sure at some point they will meet up again fairly soon, maybe tonight or tomorrow morning, we don't know. Maybe even this afternoon. I'm going to leave this beautiful young leopard now. We've had a wonderful sighting of her. And I think she deserves a rest. So we're going to leave her and see what else we can find this afternoon. So let's cross over to Jamie and see what she is up to.
I'm practicing being a lion, everybody, after a very big meal. I had a very big meal for lunch today. It was delicious. Yum, yum. Did you eat it, Jean-Ray? Did you enjoy the lunch?
Yes.
Excellent, good. You, thankfully, are not quite as recumbent as these lions
Obviously
are.
Obviously as forgettable across the dinner table.
Yes. Oh, you were sitting across the dinner table from me. I do apologize. Anyway, there are the lions. They haven't moved at all. Two other cubs have not appeared. Mercifully, none of them have relieved themselves further, which is one must be grateful for small mercies. But otherwise, not a great deal has gone on here. Certainly a larger number of flies has sat on us while we've been here. I now don't want to touch any part of my own person with any other part of my own person for fear of contaminating myself with what those flies have been eating over there. We can now have a look at that dung beetle that Jean-Ray wanted to show us a little bit earlier. Delicious. There we are. Now, this is not unusual. Dung beetles do eat dung, of course, and sometimes they eat carnivore dung. And I remember I had a really nasty experience the other day. I was lying in my bed, minding my own business, reading my book, when zzzz, plop, a dung beetle landed on me. So I picked it up and I thought, oh, what a sweet little dung beetle. And I thought to myself, this is not a good place for a dung beetle to be. It is not interested in quantum biology. Let me toss it out the window and send it on its way to a piece of dung. This I did, and then I picked my book up again. And as I did that, of course, my hand passed my nose. At that point, I leapt out of bed faster than a lightning is able to strike the ground from a small cloud, and then I shot to the bathroom and washed my hands because it smelt not completely unlike that dung over there. Those dung beetles eat carnivore dung, and they also, interestingly enough, will go to carcasses, like that rotting buffalo carcass. Some species of dung beetle will go and eat rotting flesh, which is quite interesting. I mean, it's not a very sort of big nutritional gap, if you like, to go to a piece of dung like that. So be aware, everybody. If a dung beetle lands on your bed in the middle of the night, take care to smell it before touching it and getting rid of it. Do you take that as a very severe lesson, Jean-Ray? Yes? Good. Jean-Ray, of course, sleeps with the mosquito net, so it's unlikely to happen to him. Good. Right, on to the lions. Now, there was a question, I think, a little bit earlier about the lioness who has that injury. Now, I mentioned it at the beginning of the drive. She was the lioness that was walking towards, that's not her, of course. It's this one here, Jean-Ray. She was the one, of course, that went to look for the cubs. And you can just see as she breathes quite heavily that sort of hole that she has there, quite possibly caused by a slash from another lioness's claws. But it doesn't seem, unlike Mfumo's great injury, to have created any kind of discomfort. Helena, you're wondering about what the possibility of miasis in this wound is. I have to be brutally honest with you, Helena, and say I don't know what miasis is, to be honest. I would say I think it's some kind of infection from flies or something like that. That is just a standard issue wound, and I think it has been, I think it's healing quite nicely, actually. It looks much better than it was the last time I saw it. The difference between this wound and the one on Mfumo's face, of course, is that she can lick this one, so she can keep it clean completely. The lion there had to kind of hit it with his paws, and that would have been quite painful. It wouldn't have had the healing agents that is in the lioness's saliva, and so, you know, she's licking that wound and keeping it clean, so I don't think the same kind of thing is going to happen to her as happened to Mfumo, the big male. And for those of you who are wondering, Mfumo is one of the Birmingham boys, one of the big males that we have here, and he's most easily identified by the fact that he has a great big wound just on the left-hand side of his nose under his eye. And I'm, while he, I've no doubt, is not very grateful for it, I'm quite grateful for it because it makes him much more easy to identify. And let's just look at that cub over there, Jandri, if you don't mind. That's the one, you've got it there. Just look at the fur.
Which one, sorry?
The one you're, the one that's, oh, sorry, yes, there's another one. The middle one there. Now that cub there has got a lot of buffalo muck all over its fur. That's what that kind of dirt is, mixed in with the odd patch of hairless skin, or sort of regrowing hair, if you like, caused by the mange incident. And she seems to have recovered very nicely. You can see there are bits and pieces of fairly sort of sparse hair and bits of skin sticking through, and that was from the mange. But none of these cubs, or all the lionesses actually, are scratching themselves at all anymore. So that's great. They're covered in muck. Mum will clean them eventually. When they go off hunting or start moving again, you'll find, I think, that the mothers will take the cubs in hand and clean them. And they'll clean each other. And I think they do that, you know. I mean, we talk about how resilient they are and how resistant to disease and how they're able to get over eating the foulest possible stuff. I think what they try and do, I suspect one of the main reasons cats clean each other and clean themselves so fastidiously is that they don't want to stink when they are on the hunt. If they smell like a walking carcass, then it's going to be that much more obvious for their predator or their prey to pick them up when they're on the stalk. However, if they just smell like lion, and I don't think lion smells very strong. If you sit in this proximity to lions and they haven't relieved themselves with the tar-like dung, what you find is that they don't actually smell at all. Hyena's not really the same, dog's not the same, but they have completely different hunting strategies. Those are two animals that like to hunt by coursing, so they're not worried about stalking their animals, where of course lions and leopards have to stalk as close as possible to their possible prey, and I think that's why they're such fastidious cleaners of themselves. Let us find out Jamie Patterson's opinion on the matter. She is in the tent.
The joy, of course, of being in the tent out here is that I get to watch James and Byron while they're with their leopards and lions, and also at the same time enjoy the various animal visitors that come wandering through. In this particular case, a male and what looks like a female at the back, or might be a young male, but a small herd of Nyala. And isn't that a nice office to have on an afternoon? I might not be out in the vehicle or out on walk, which is, of course, one of our that's the place we love to be, but this is the next best thing. I hear that James has been talking about dung beetles and his incredibly unfortunate, sorry, I didn't actually flap up this tent as well as I should have, just negotiate my way in through here. I hear that James has been talking about his incredibly unfortunate, really rather pungent experience with his dung beetle. And I thought, well, you know, Dewey's fine. I don't know if any of you remember Dewey. Dewey is the massive dung beetle that we found on drive not too long ago that I brought to the tent so that we can examine him slightly more closely. But I made a very unfortunate, rather grievous error. I sniffed him. Ugh. Obviously, Dewey has been casually decomposing in my car for the last few days in 40-degree heat, over 100 degree Fahrenheit at times in that car. So I don't really blame him for smelling. It's not because he's been... This is a herbivore dung beetle, so it will go for things like elephant dung and rhino or whatever it happens to find. It's not after predator scat. But he has been decomposing. I would not advise it. Vian, would you like a sniff? No. Not really. No, that's a good call. Now, Dewey, of course, was a source of intense fascination, because once you realize where a dung beetle's eyes are, you start to view them in a whole different light. So his eyes are hidden underneath his body, and he's only got a small portion of them that actually stick out above his head. You can also see how vastly furry this particular chap is. And, of course, with his shovel-faced, or shovel-head, look at that. The more you look at them, the stranger they start to look when you realize where their mouths and their eyes are positioned. They start to look most peculiar. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to put Dewey under the microscope so that you can really see exactly what his eyes are like, because I don't often get to play with a microscope. Still, no rover for me. I'm obviously not trusted after James dumped the rover in the Juma Dam, somewhat unfortunately. There we go. So I should have sorted out the focus, and although you can see the bright lights of, and you can actually see Viam. You can see Viam reflected in his eye. There we go. You can see him moving around. Wave, Viam. Hello. You can also see the bright lights of the microscope, but you can really see into that eyeball. How amazing is that? And I just had to show you that. And then I also wanted to explore. And I have to do it this way because, oh, goodness gracious. I have to do it this way because I'm shaking too much from my caffeine, my cup of coffee, to actually do it out of my hand. I'm trying to, oh, okay. Well, we'll just go with the other eye, shall we? Let's do that. And just have a look at the incredible, actually quite beautiful fur all around him. We don't tend to think of dung beetles as furry, but Dewey most certainly was. Dewey the dung beetle, who may or may not have been a female or a male, I'm not 100% sure, but he does have the most extraordinary fur. While I search for other things to put under the microscope to keep myself thoroughly entertained, let's head back over to James and those lions.
An enormous warm welcome to the Virginia Society for Technology and Education, the annual conference thereof in Virginia Beach. That is a lion. My name is James Hendry, and it's lovely to have you with us here at Safari Live. Jean-André is on camera. Well done, Jean-André. That's Jean-André's thumb, everybody, and hopefully the last we'll see of him. Okay, let's go back to the lions here. Jamie is in the tent today. She's going to be showing you some of the smaller, more, I suppose, intellectual aspects of living out here. And then we have Byron and Brian. They are with the spotted prince of cats, in this case the princess of cats, a leopard. I will introduce you to these characters very shortly. Please do send us your questions if you'd like to. We'd love to talk to you over the course of the next 20 minutes or so. I think that's all you're with us for. Maybe it's half an hour, maybe we can stretch it. And we'll show you some of the great creatures that we follow here on Safari Live. Here we have the famous Nkuhuma Pride, 5 lionesses, 4 little cubs that there are here now. There are 2 missing, sadly, but that's just the way it goes with Lion Society, of course. We have a situation where, well, often there's a huge amount of attrition. So 1 in 8 lion cubs makes it to adulthood. The rest of them, I'm afraid, fall by the wayside as they grow up, despite the immense protection provided by the lionesses here. And one of the most common things, of course, we're asked is, where are the males? Well, the males, of course, are not part of the pride, unlike the Lion King would have you believe. This pride and another pride, the Styx Pride, live within the realm of the gangsters of the bush, I call them. That is the Birmingham Boys, and there are 4 male lions in that coalition, in that gang, and they dominate the Nkuhuma Pride and the Styx Pride to the south, and possibly another pride off to the east. A huge, huge area they dominate, probably over, let's say about 15,000 acres or so. So it's a big land, and the 3 little prides sit within that area there. So there they are. They killed a buffalo this morning. Unfortunately, they moved away from that, and it's highly unlikely that they'll go back to the cubs, at least to the kill, before the end of the day, so when it gets dark. Caroline, you're wondering how many cubs there are on a litter. Well, the last three litters that this pride had were 3, 2, and 3. Now, 3 is probably the most common, 2 not uncommon, 4 also not uncommon, very unlikely to have 1, very unlikely to have more than 4, but there have been cases of 6 or so recorded, very unlikely that they would survive unless they were in captivity, because of course a lioness, if you look there, has only got 4 teats, and so she's only really got space to feed 4 hungry little cubs at a time. That's not to say it's impossible for her to feed more, but in out here where there are so many stresses and strains to lion life, it's very unlikely. Heather, of course, the other very common thing that we get asked is, are we ever scared out here when perhaps a lion or a leopard has approached too closely? Yes. Absolutely, I've been scared once or twice out here by lions and leopards, mostly on foot though. In the vehicle, they just don't seem to see us in the same way that they do when we're on foot. But we had the most amazing experience with the leopard you're about to meet now on foot, and we weren't scared at all. And that's just because we've become inured to them, we're trained, we know how to read the body language of the animals out here. And so we don't ever want to be in a position where we're scared, because if we are scared, the chances are that the animals in front of us are scared too, because if an animal is showing you aggression or anger, what it's saying to you is, you've made me afraid and I want you to move away. And we make sure, as far as possible, that we don't ever do that. So we get into a position, we read the body language of the animals, we read their behavior, and make sure that we stay in a space where they are completely comfortable with us and ideally completely oblivious and ignoring us, like these lions are. They're living their lives of lions, and we are sitting here simply as observers, not as participants. And that's a particularly important part of what we do here. We want to be as sensitive as possible to these animals so that we can learn as much about them as we can without influencing their behavior in any way. You can see that we're having about as much influence on these animals as, well, an anesthetic might, I suppose. They are fast asleep and unlikely to move until the sun goes down. That's when they'll get up. I think they'll probably go back to their buffalo kill, which is sitting next to a waterhole not too far from here. They moved away from it during the day and they've come to lie in the shade here. Right, Jamie Patterson is in the tent. She'd like you to show you some of the more, I suppose, intimate aspects of what we do out here. So go and meet her in the safari tent.
And a very warm welcome to the Virginia Society for Technology in Education, and I fear that all of you are at your annual conference in Virginia Beach. Now, my name is Jamie, and this afternoon, Viam is the man holding the camera, and we are standing in the middle of the most extraordinary set that I think you can get in the bush out here. So we're right in the middle of the wild, I mean, open to us, so that you can see the vegetation outside. There's some birds flying around. So we're right in the middle of the bush, but of course we've got this amazing collection here in the tent. So we have the vehicles, we often do bushwalks, but we also have the tent as a sort of a more scientific base and a chance to really have a closer look at many of the different things out here. So obviously we've got our wall of specimens, complete with the many skulls, a collection of various bug species, and every time we do encounter a bug that we find that's dead or an insect that is dead, we bring it back and we put it in a jar, and then we have a chance to more closely examine it. So the tent essentially is a really lovely insight into the more intimate aspects and the anatomy of the various animals. And we'll go into that in slightly more depth, but there's actually a huge amount to show you, and unfortunately, I just don't have the time to fully go over it. Obviously, we've got all of our skulls. You've seen some of them. We've got a leopard skull. We've got a wild dog skull. Gives a really nice insight into the way in which animal teeth and dentition, the different diets that they eat, the way in which that will affect their dental structure, essentially. Then, of course, we have odd moments like this, where we have the amazing snake skin, for example. This one belonged to a black mamba that was found when out on a walk in the bush. is an absolutely magnificent, absolutely massive specimen. That's a wonderful way of essentially teaching kids about things like this, particularly snakes, insects, creepy crawlies, stuff that they might be terrified of, yet at the same time, it gives us this opportunity to actually teach them to have respect and actually ultimately come to really appreciate the role of such creatures in this ecosystem, in this incredibly delicate ecosystem. It is absolutely special. Let me pop it here. Now, Rhonda, you want to know, because obviously you were with James in the Nkuhuma Pride, and shortly you will be meeting one of our leopard cubs. You want to know who comes up with the names or the groups of the animals. How do we name them? It's very much a mutual decision. There are other guides that work in this area. There are other guides that work in lodges in this area. So a lot of that is done through a mutual, a democratic process. The names are put forward by the various people who see those animals, and they will be given, particularly with the leopards, a name that is suitable to their characters. With lions, it's slightly more complicated, and they're often named either for the area that they're in with prides or where they've come from with males. The Nkuhumas, that means brown ivory tree in the local language, and it was a name that was given to that lion pride because they were found regularly in one of their favorite spots underneath a tree. So the naming process is quite a complex one. We try to go with Chitsonga names, which is one of the local languages or the local language groups in this area. Not always, but that's often the way that we approach things. Now, I'm sure you're all excited about learning a little bit more about the leopard cubs and leopard characters, and I think without any further ado, let's send you over to Byron so that he can show you what he has for you.
And hello, we are still sitting with this beautiful young female leopard, Shungile. My name is Byron. Good afternoon to all the schools, all the teachers rather. And Brian is on camera with me this afternoon, and he's very famous thumb. Now, we were very fortunate we got to find this young female a little bit earlier, and she's been very, very... She's been very kind to us. She's been resting and lying not far from us up on the termite mound. Look at her tongue sticking out. Now, this is Shungile, the male, the female that James mentioned he saw on foot the other day. And what an incredible experience that was. And Jamie also mentioned... Now, Samantha, you want to know if any of these animals allow us to get close enough to touch them? No. So, Samantha, they don't, but also we wouldn't try. These are wild animals, and we would not at all try to touch them because we potentially put ourselves in danger as well as the animals. Because if something happens, then, you know, the action would be taken against the animal probably, and you know, we could also cause injury to ourselves because of that. We are very, very respectful of the animal's space, and we do not try and touch them or harm them in any way. So we are purely here to view, observe, and interpret the bush and the animals and their behavior to viewers. So no, we would not try and touch them at all. Now, this beautiful young female leopard, Shungile, has a sibling, Hosana. And they are two leopards that we see fairly regularly because their mother, Karula, is a well-known leopard, and she is probably the most dominant female leopard on Juma, where we are at the moment. So we have been very fortunate and seen her for many years. And we've seen them grow, or we've seen her raise a few different cubs, and we've seen these young cubs from a very young age grow up, and now they are just over 10 months old, so still very young and still very reliant on the female. They do rely on her for food, so I think at the moment, and what does happen is she will leave the cubs in an area. Karula will go off and hunt during the day or during the evening, and if she does manage to kill something, she will return, fetch the cubs, call for them, fetch them, and then take them to the kill so that they may also feed. But at the moment, they are getting to that age where they're almost a year old, so they're getting a bit more adventurous, and they're exploring. So the cubs don't stay together as much anymore. And what's happening is the young male is moving off a little bit on his own, not too far, still in the area where the mother would have left them. But they are exploring, and this female did it this morning too. She's been walking around a bit, but again, staying kind of in the area that the female did leave them, so that if she does come back and calls for them, they will find her again so that they can follow her to a kill for food. Now, usually, leopards will become independent anywhere between a year and a year and a half. The average age is about a year and a half, so 18 months. And then what will happen is the female will chase them off, and she will hiss and growl and make it very clear that she's no longer going to look after them. And she will chase them off, and they will have to start fending for themselves. Now, Amy, you wanted to know if these animals prey on each other in a natural environment. Yes, this is completely a natural environment, so they do prey on other animals. Leopards, for example, will prey on a wide variety of species, ranging from birds, small mammals, all the way up to larger mammals like the impala, kudu, or inyala, which are all antelope that we get in this area. So yes, that's exactly what they prey on. The predators usually try and avoid each other, but if anything, a lion is obviously the largest and most powerful predator. So what they would do is they would potentially kill, especially some of these young cubs if they come across them, purely because of competition. They will not tolerate having young leopards in their area, but leopards are able to move up, they are able to climb up into a tree and escape those predators, which is very helpful. I'm going to leave this young leopard now. We've had a wonderful view of her for most of the afternoon. We're going to let her rest, and we are going to see what else we can find. While I do that, let's cross back to James and see what he has got.
Now, we found something else, everyone. We left the lions because they're fast asleep doing nothing, of course. But one of the things that little leopard that you've just met is going to learn to kill fairly soon are these. They're tiny little baby impalas, and the impala is the most common antelope that we get here. Beautiful, beautiful antelopes. But unfortunately, they're on the menu for just about everything. They're just about the right size for all the major predators. Cheetah, wild dogs, hyenas, lions, and leopards will all eat impala. And that is one of the ewes who just had her babies, and we've just come out of November, of course, which means that all of them just about have given birth. So they give birth in an extremely synchronized fashion. Probably 90% or 95% of the babies will be birthed within 2 weeks of each other. So they flood the market, and it means that although lots of them get taken out before their first birthday, many of them survived adulthood, and they're extremely effective out here. Excuse me, a small frog in my throat. That is the male there. He is obviously male on account of the fact that he has horns. And he is now in an impenetrable thicket, so we cannot see him any longer. Let us continue along the road. I'm going down towards a clearing over here, hoping that we might be lucky to see a few other antelope species and some other general game. Maybe, if we're very lucky, an elephant. Now, Amy, you say because we are in a closed environment, do we take the time to monitor the life cycles of the animals and sort of perhaps manipulate slightly the ecology of the area? Amy, we're not in a small closed environment in the slightest. We're in 8.5 million acres. That's three times the size of the Yellowstone National Park. So we're in a massive, massive transfrontier conservation area. It consists of private reserves here that we're on the western fringes of the Kruger Park. The Kruger National Park itself, the Limpopo National Park in Mozambique off to the east, and to the north of us, Zimbabwe's Gonarezou National Park. So that's 3.5 million hectares or 8.5 million acres or so of contiguous wildlife land. That's as near as you can get to an open system out here in this part of the world. So no, there's extremely little done to manipulate the ecology at all. Anna, you want to know what the weather's like? At the moment, it's absolutely glorious. It's about 28 degrees Celsius, 82 or so Fahrenheit. It feels wonderful. The sun's setting. We're in the middle of a wonderful summer. There's been some good rain this year, so at the moment, it's beautiful. In winter, it's almost like paradise, really. It drops to about 4 degrees Celsius, which isn't very cold at all in Fahrenheit. It's about 40 or so. And then it goes up to, a very pleasant sort of 70 to 75 on some days in the middle of winter, and for 3 months we don't see a cloud. It's just beautiful deep blue skies. And then as we go into springtime, which is sort of September to, well, I guess halfway through November, but it's basically September and October, then it's quite hot. There's a tiny squirrel sitting on a branch. Don't move, Jean-André, don't move. It's moved. It's obviously got a nest in this tree. It's gone into a nest on this tree. It's a tiny little squirrel. I'm just going to see if it doesn't stick its head out again. While I do that, I'll just quickly tell you, Hannah, more about the weather. So September and October can be beastly hot here. It'll regularly push sort of 95, and it feels so much hotter because there hasn't been any rain. It doesn't rain in the winter. Winter is the dry season. And then as we go into November, December, well, it's still very hot. It can regularly hit 100 degrees, but you can see that the cloud is starting to gather now, and that's because we get these afternoon thunderstorms every so often, and that cools things down and leaves the atmosphere with this wonderful sense of anticipation and expectation. Anyway, so that's what the weather's like. Then January and February, pretty much the same as November and December. March, April, May, glorious, glorious weather. It's cooler than it is now. Everything's green and lush and beautiful. And that's really, I think, my favorite weather time out here. Right, we're going to go down towards the clearing here. Jamie's over there in the tent with a whole lot of gadgets.
A whole load of gadgets, and just before James was waxing lyrical about the incredible weather that we have here in South Africa, and in particular in the bush, you were looking at some antelope with James called impala. And we don't have any impala skulls, but we do have a collection of antelope skulls. So of course, it gives you really nice insight into... I was talking earlier about the dentition. You can start to have a look at, obviously, as browsers and as grazers, the way in which their molars are shaped for that particular purpose. And there we go. That is a dacre skull, which is a type of antelope. Name means diver. That is a dacre skull. And I'm going to pop it back in a second and show you in complete contrast, of course. I'm actually slightly terrified of breaking this particular skull. Oh. When you compare it to a baboon, for example, that is an omnivore, so not a herbivore, but an omnivore. And of course, with those absolutely massive, terribly terrifying canines that are used purely, well, essentially purely for defensive purposes and for fighting with other males and other baboons. And fighting off leopards and lions as well will be one of the main features. But then relatively flat, almost human-like molars. So there you go. Interesting, intricate little nuances between the different creatures and the different skulls that we have here. And then, oh goodness, don't want to break this. I'm always so terrified I'm going to when I play with these. I play with them so regularly. Let me put this down here. It would be disastrous. James would kill me. And then we have, of course, our leopards and our carnivores with their completely different molar structure, with the slicing, with the biting, carnassial shear. So really, we've got a really nice way of essentially tying in all of your educational aims, your curriculum aims, chatting about ecosystems and actually giving the kids a really nice practical example, and then obviously an anatomical example of the way in which everything connects out here. And including... the small creepy crawlies. This is a dung beetle that I picked up a little bit earlier, and a dung beetle might seem to be a very unpleasant thing. They are actually incredibly useful and vitally important in most of the continents except Antarctica, on the basis that they, as their name suggests, collect dung and help to get rid of it. And they basically essentially are the garbage collectors of this particular area. Now, one of the joys of the tent, one of the things that I love the most about the tent, is I get to play with all of the gadgets, as James said. And what we're going to do quickly to give you just a brief demonstration is pop our friend the dung beetle underneath this little microscope. We've got a little handheld microscope. And I'm going to show you, hopefully, what the eye looks like. So that is the eye of that particular dung beetle, and we can fiddle with the... Whoopsie daisy. We can fiddle with the focus, obviously, to get different views of different parts. You really get an idea of how furry dung beetles are. And we tend not to think of arthropods or insects as furry, but this particular one is. And these, all of these little hairs will play such an important sensory part. There we go, Jamie. You want to know, Jamie to Jamie, you want to know what is the purpose of the dung beetle's fur. It's a sensory purpose, and it's a protective purpose. So essentially it stops pieces of tiny bits of debris getting stuck into the dung beetle itself or going into, because of course, like many arthropods, they have segmented body parts. So just imagine it's basically like bits of grit getting into tools, essentially clogging up the works. It's also because dung beetles are very busily rolling balls. So that's a way of feeling their way away. Now, Sally, you want to know what sort of a training one needs to be a safari guide. Sally, it's very varied. You'll find that all of us have very different backgrounds. I, for example, actually did a law degree before I started officially training to become a guide. Many places offer training courses. Obviously, having some kind of background in biology or in science, natural sciences, is always a huge help. I have to tell you that one of my favorite things is doing the school drives, taking the questions of the school kids. I feel it's one of the most important things that we actually do here at Wild Earth and here with Safari Live. Just in terms of really giving these kids an opportunity to connect to nature, some of them may not have the opportunity in their future, perhaps they will, to come and visit these amazing wild areas, but it really does, in my experience, build a connection. We have very many young viewers that have been watching for months and months and months, and we've built up a personal connection with them, and we've got to know them exceptionally well, and the passion that it ignites within them is absolutely astounding. And of course, as the future conservation leaders of the world, the future scientists, politicians, or wherever they happen to end up, an intrinsic interest in what's happening in the world out here is exceptionally valuable. I hope that you have all enjoyed it. Unfortunately, for those of you at the conference, it is time for us to say goodbye to you. We will be continuing with our normal drive, but I hope this has given a little bit of insight into what it is we do, and I do hope we'll be seeing you and your students on the back of our safari vehicles. For now, let us head back over to James.
That's very lucky. Well, that was a grey go-away bird that sat there for roughly 10 minutes and then became extremely camera shy as you came across to see it. Oh well. Right, let's carry on. We had some impala up ahead here. We can go and have a look at them. My plan for the rest of the afternoon, everybody, now that the school side of things is finished, so I can tell you what we're going to do for the rest of the afternoon, is to sort of drive around here, see if we can find some tracks, maybe of Karula or something else, pop down to a waterhole or two. But then I think as it gets a bit cooler, we'll do one last pass over Sydney's Dam and see if we can't find those other two cubs, and maybe the rest of the pride will go towards them. So we'll head up towards the pride and see if they get on the move a little bit later. That is the plan. Of course, plans out here change extremely often. In the meantime, Byron has a bird that is not camera shy. Let's go and find out what it is.
All right, wow, look at this, everyone. We've just found a little pearl-spotted owl. Now, that is incredible, and what happened was there was another bird alarm calling. I'm trying to see, it looked like a thrush. A little thrush was alarm calling, a very strange sound. So stopped to have a look and spotted a beautiful pearl-spotted owl. And isn't that great? Look at the back of its head. It's got two black markings that appear to be eyes. Looks like eyes on the back of its head. Now that's a tiny, tiny owl. This is incredible. What a wonderful, wonderful sighting. You can hear that thrush calling, that alarm call. So the reason why it's doing that is it's probably trying to mob it. And they mob these owls even though there's no direct threat. These owls are seen as predators. So they often birds try to chase them away. I want to see if I don't move back slightly if I can get a better view for you. Just roll back a little bit. How's that, Brian? Is that a bit better? There we go. And you can see it clearly now. Oh, that is so wonderful. That is a very, very fantastic surprise. And they've got a beautiful call. I won't do it now because sometimes they do feel intimidated and they are quite territorial. So when we drive away later, I will do the call for you, but I'm not going to do it now or play the call. But look at that head constantly rotating around, having a look out. Now these little owls will feed on insects, reptiles, little mice. So that really is a fantastic little sighting of one. And you often hear them, but they're not easy to spot because they are so small. There it goes, it'll just fly off there.
Yeah.
Gone. But what an incredible, incredible little sighting. Yeah. Wasn't that wonderful? Eh? What a surprise. I'm sure it's flown into a tree somewhere. Not too far. And it's not an often sighting, it's not a sighting that we get very often. These owls are secretive. That owl is about the size of my hand. Very, very small. So not a big owl at all. And you can imagine to try and spot them in trees is not easy. So fortunately, you know, out here we rely on everything that we can hear, see, smell, all those senses. And that was purely found because we heard the thrush alarm calling. And that alerted us to that there might be a predator in the area. Could be anything. Could have been a snake. Could have been a mongoose. But fortunately, it was a little owl. Now, their call sounds like this. Now, let me see if I can do it for you. Beautiful call, very beautiful call, whistle sound that they make, and you'll often hear it out in the bush. But to find them is very difficult, but I'm so glad we got to show you. Now, James has another little bird he'd like to show you.
Well, we've gone from the big cats to the little birdies, and that, everybody, is a thrush. Isn't he lovely? Now, I'll tell you why I like the thrush while I find a picture of him for you in the book, because that's not a very good picture that Jandre is producing for you. That is not Jandre's fault. It is the fault of the background against which the thrush is sitting. Thrush used to live in Johannesburg, of course. There are plenty of them living there. And I've told you many times my story of why I love the Cape Robin so much. It was my little touch to the wilderness when I lived in the big city of Johannesburg. But also, at the one place that I lived, it was a kind of run-down little cottage in a quite salubrious area. That's how I managed to sort of live in that area. Yeah, that's what it is there. It's called a curriken thrush. It's that one there. Beautiful. Anyway, that's what he is. He's got a beautiful call, as you can hear. Anyway, as I was living in this run-down cottage, I really quite liked it because it had thatch on the roof and it had a huge fig tree out the side. And underneath the fig tree, these little thrushes used to sit in the evenings, and they'd sort of fossick around there looking for things to eat, and they'd make this beautiful call. And it was just wonderful having that little touch of the wild in the garden while the mayhem of the city was going on all around. It was a great way to spend an evening with the thrushes of number 60 Sutherland Avenue. I sadly went past that house the other day, and it has been bashed down and destroyed, and there is now some giant monstrosity there. I don't know if the fig tree survived, but I seriously doubt it. Anyway, each to his own, you know, this is the price of progress. Kill paradise and put up a parking lot, I think the saying goes. Hopefully not here ever. It's a bit morbid, isn't it, Jandre? A bit morbid. Right, we have another bird on the ground. I think we should move on to birds. It's flown away. We won't move on to that bird. It was a ring-necked dove. As I was saying, it's turned into a most beautiful afternoon. The sun is now setting. There's a bit of cloud in the sky dissipating the light. The temperature is perfect. There might be some rain in the offing. It's just wonderful to be out here. And there is... Oh, there's a whole lot of life here, most of it running away as fast as it can. Well, there's a red-billed hornbill over there. There was a lilac-breasted roller not too far away. Oh, dear. And there are a whole lot of little dwarf mongoose that have gone into that little termite mound over there. They are now invisible. Lucy, you were saying, how do I spot something that is so small? Lucy, it's because I'm so young and my eyes are in such fine condition. That is, of course, absolute rubbish. I am neither very young, but my eyes mercifully have not failed me just yet. Lucy, all it is, you know, I actually don't have great eyes. That's not to cast aspersions on them, but it's experience. Your eyes learn and your brain learns to pick up the images that your eyes see, and it's just through experience and spending time in a place like this that you're able to look at, pick out details that are perhaps slightly out of place, or perhaps you hear the bird, your ears become inured to the sounds out here, and that's basically how you do it. It's got nothing to do with any superpower, any genetic talent, or some people are certainly better at spotting than others. But what you find, for example, is that kids, I remember always when I was guiding in a big team, the guys who'd grown up on farms had much better sense of perception and much better ability to discern details from the wilderness than those of us who came from cities were. And then slowly we all kind of leveled out as we spent more and more time learning to pick out the details out here. There's some pigs running up ahead. Very highly mobile pigs. I was trying to find an alliteration for that. For pigs, Jandre? Perambulating pigs, perhaps? Parading. They weren't really parading so much as running away. Petrified pigs, there we go. They really were so terrified, they're now completely invisible. They've gone in there somewhere. Anyway, we're approaching Treehouse Dam. We'll see what's there. And Treehouse Dam, we did say as these dams were being sort of dug out in preparation for the deluge, we thought, I wonder if the deluge will come. So far it hasn't. So we'll go down to Treehouse Puddle, see what's there. While we do that, Jamie seems to be in mortal danger.
The terrifying view. I wonder how many poor hapless antelope have had this of their last few moments, this particular view. Vim and myself have been playing with skulls. Enough now, Vim. And snatch that away before you do something to it, you rogue you. Yes, we have been playing with leopard skulls. Now, I was going to ask this next question as a quiz, but I'm not going to. I'm going to tell you the answer to it, although perhaps some of you would have got it at home. So I'll ask it very quickly, and then I'll give you the answer straight away. So it's more like a quiz for yourself in your own head. Since we have been examining dental structure and the various animals and beasts that we get out here, do you know what South African member of the carnivore order has the most teeth? It's a funny answer, and it's not one that you'd expect. It's not an animal that we see here, unfortunately. It is an animal that I have seen very many times when I was working in the desert, and it is a tiny little canid called a bat-eared fox. Now, a bat-eared fox has the most teeth, between 46 and 50 teeth in its mouth. Don't know why it needs so many teeth, because it eats insects, particularly likes termites. So I'm not quite sure about the necessity for having that many teeth in your mouth, but that apparently is the answer. In terms of mammals and in terms of the carnivore order, the bat-eared fox has the most teeth. So there you go. An interesting little aside. I asked it as a sort of a quiz for yourself to just think of very quickly. Now, earlier we touched on this terrifying thing, and I actually think this might be a more terrifying view than that of the leopard skull. Now, we've spoken many, many times, and I'm sure James has touched on this in the tent before, about just how dangerous a male baboon can really be. And with those canines, you can understand why. They are absolutely massive, and a male baboon is twice the size of a female, and the canines are actually the size of basically a leopard's, actually a bit larger than a leopard's. And then they've got those sort of almost zebra-like incisors here, obviously as part of their diet, but a completely different skull structure and a completely, I find, a far more intimidating shape to their face. I don't know if we spoke about this morning with our baboon troop. I don't know whether it's something to do with childhood memories, but I do find male baboons to be a very intimidating thing. And with a massive head like that, I'm sorry, I'm so terrified, I'm going to break it. I'm going to put it down very gently. Please don't fall down. I live in utter terror that I'm not going to put a skull back properly and then the wind is going to blow. And you heard about the great deluge that James mentioned. I live in terror that I'm actually going to drop one of these skulls one day, and I will be in, I might as well run away, and James is going to find me and possibly eviscerate me. Compared, of course, to the far more harmless, but nevertheless, not to be underestimated, jaw of the vervet monkey. We've seen Karula, we've seen Shadow, we've seen many of our leopards eat monkeys before, so they do catch and they do eat them, and this skull is basically like a mouthful for a leopard. And there you go. I had a chance to play with my skulls. I do enjoy it. Now, Lucy, you want to know if the baboons... Oh, gosh, here we go again. Lucy, you want to know if baboons have the same bite power as leopards. Not quite as far as I know, but almost. I think it comes very, very close, Lucy. So they have very large skulls, but their heads don't necessarily, in my opinion, have the same level of muscle attachment. They don't need that massive crushing power that most of our big predators, including leopards, lions, and of course, the obvious one being hyenas. They don't need that massive crushing power. And I would actually guess and say that the length, this is a guess, but it just to me anatomically wise, the length of the skull is actually going to be a disadvantage just in terms of its elongation for bite pressure, because the shorter, the stockier, just in my head in terms of muscle attachments and physics, the muscle attachments for a shorter skull will have that greater gripping power, whereas with for a baboon, slightly more extended, slightly narrower face, they just don't have quite the same. I mean, it's intimidating, and they've got the bi-force needed to puncture skin. Reese, you have spotted something very, very good point. You're looking at the lower mandibles. They have them on the upper mandibles as well. Reese wants to know about these holes. And they are called, oh my goodness, you are right, they are holes for nerves. There's the bottom mandible, the hole in the bottom mandible. You are absolutely correct in that it is a passage for nerves that are obviously traveling from the brain. The mouth and the face is a very important part of any big cat, not just for chewing and biting, for all sorts of things, from the whiskers to feeling, the expressions of the face, because that's where a lot of the animal's expression and their body language, and it is called, oh, for goodness sake, it's going to drive me insane.
A large male leopard. I don't think it was Anderson. It was far too far east for Anderson, and I don't know if any of you have seen that clip of Anderson on the... I guess you should go to the Londolozi blog, see if you can find it there. The Anderson male was recently seen hoisting a fully grown male impala up into a tree, and as he got it up, I mean, he must have been... oh, I don't know, a good 20 feet off the ground, 30 feet off the ground. He lost his footing completely. He dropped the kill and he fell out of the tree and landed, as all cats do, on his feet. And so he might still be sort of licking his wounds, as it were, at this point. Go and check it out, probably on the Londolozi blog. I'm sure you'll find it there. So we'll drive along the boundary road. In fact, let's not drive along the boundary. Let's go into Arethusa. And then we'll drive along a much prettier road called Parallel Road. And in fact, now those are the tracks of baboons. We've been seeing many baboons of late. They are such great entertainment. I suspect they've headed towards the camp in the hopes of finding something to steal. They're also like a sort of criminal gang, where lions are the upper-class gangs of the bush, I feel. The baboons are the more low-class, street urchin kind of gangs of the wilderness, I feel. With the real royalty, of course, the elephants and the leopards. Let's go this way. See if we don't get very lucky. Oh, the light has just softened so nicely now. I think we'll get a beautiful sunset probably from the Arethusa airstrip. Or the Arethusa International. I once described the Arethusa International airstrip, of course, as the Arethusa International airstrip, and there was a flurry of concern from people that Boeing 747s and the Airbus A380 were about to disgorge thousands of people into this reserve. I was, of course, being entirely facetious. It is just a little airstrip for bush planes to land on. Fear not. There's not about to be a great dissension of double-decker aeroplanes and a disgorging of tourists. Yes, now, Arethusa, let's hope you can deliver us something right now. Ooh, I must change the channel so I can hear if there's anything entertaining going on here. So also, at this time of the year, what you want to start doing is looking into all of the termite mounds, because of course there are snakes lurking around the termite mounds, and it's always so very special to see a snake on drive. Especially if it's a mamba, or something equally terrifying like that. Do mambas terrify you, Jandre? No? Well, they should. I think they're very terrifying indeed. Try and find a flower or two as well. Ooh, there's one, hang on. Do you see the flower there, Jandre? Let me get out and take a closer look at it. Of course, when one gets out the car, one must take a closer look at everything, just to make sure one is not about to be eaten by the Anderson male. Ah, now, this to me looks like a Tracheandra species, but I'm going to ask my wonderful source of knowledge on the internet, Judy H, and her team of flower identifiers to make sure whether that is in fact a Tracheandra species or not. I'll show you the one in the book that I think it is. And so far we've learned quite a few through the internet. Now, one of them being Gusha, of course, that wonderful yellow flower that is edible. There we are. I'm not going to pick it, of course, because one mustn't pick wild flowers. One can pick the odd sedge, though. This is the white button sedge. And always makes me feel quite cheerful because, of course, it's a summer flower that doesn't come up in the winter time. It means that there's moisture in the soil, things are growing, and we're heading towards the Christmas holidays. Wonderful. Right, I will try and find that white flower in the book as we drive along. Well, I haven't plugged myself in. Hang on a second. There we are. I'm now plugged in. There is quite a lot of noise on the radio. Of course, I cannot hear what was going on. I'll get a little bit deeper into Arethusa and find out. At the moment, it sounds like a very exciting rugby match going on. While I figure out what's going on, Byron has found a long-tailed bird that is coloured piebald.
A beautiful magpie shrike, James, and it's perched up in the sun. Beautiful light at the moment, really, really incredible light. This is a photographer's dream, this natural sunlight. You probably won't have to change too much to a photograph if you are photographing in this. And then there are some other birds around, and some that I do enjoy and always make me laugh. Let's see where it is now. There we go. The grey go-away bird. Quack, quack. I'm so sorry, my grey go-away bird call is probably not very good. But they are wonderful birds, you see. Beautiful crest. And I wonder if they'll call for us. There were one or two around here. There it goes. There it goes. Lovely view of it. And now I'm not too far from Biffles Hook Dam, so I'm going to go and have a look, explore around there and see if there's anything of interest. Who knows? We haven't been lucky the last few times I've been to Biffles Hook Dam. It's been very, very quiet. Maybe this afternoon is different. We've had a lucky afternoon so far. Oh, grumpy old man, you wanted to know if we would go back to the Hardy Dart chicks. Yes. Yes, we will. This afternoon I will. I'll go have a look and see if we can get a view of them before we lose the light. I'm going to quickly check Biffles Hook Dam and then I'll head straight down there. So stay with us because I will try and see if those chicks are around later. Hopefully the adult is on the nest. That would be great to see. And now all I'm hoping for is a herd of elephant drinking at Biffles Hook Dam and splashing mud on themselves. That would be incredible. Let's see, what do you think, Brian? Either that or a kudu. that's my other thought. I mean, we could try and make it easy and say the three-banded plover. Yeah, I've got a feeling we'd see one of those. Yeah. Oh, buffalo weaver, yeah. Have a look. Now I don't see any elephant, unfortunately. And I don't seem to see any kudu. Oh dear. Let's have a quick look. I'll stop on the dam wall and see what we can find. And there appears to be very little here this afternoon, again, unfortunately. Oh, I can hear a red-chested cuckoo calling in the distance. Let's see if we can hear it. Beautiful call. And where are all the little plovers? There's a blacksmith plover down at the bottom on the other side. And oh, there's a swallow flying above us. Which one is it now? To try have a look at these swallows is very difficult. Red-breasted swallow. That's what that is. Very difficult to see. Let's see if it comes back. Brian, it might come back. There it goes. Let's see. I mean, this is really difficult. Wow, that's amazing, Brian. Well done. The red-breasted swallow, that is incredibly difficult to see. And there it goes. Well done. There, you get that rufous belly and... There we go. Some of you might be getting dizzy. Oh, it's great to see them. Beautiful swallows. All right, so I think with our birding in mind, while we've still got a bit of light, I'm going to try and race to that area where we had those beautiful chicks this morning, the Hardy-Dar chicks, and see if they're still hanging around. Let's head over to James quickly and get an update from him. I'll see you later.
I told you a lie, everybody. It is not Tracheandrus spicatus. That is a grass. Why I confused that plant with a grass, I cannot say to you, but I did find, I think, what it is. And I will just quickly survey the international airstrip here and tell you that there doesn't seem to be a great deal going on. So as we ease our way down, I shall show you. It's something called chlorophytum, I believe. And it is in my funny little book that my mum gave me before I became a ranger guide person. Wasn't that nice of me, mum? Chandray? Yes, of course it was. It's because my mum is nice. Yours is not nice, Sir Chandray. She begat you. Ergo, she cannot possibly be as nice as mine. There it is. Would you like me to stop? I will not take it back, Chandray. I'll film the flower. You've forgotten how to zoom in. Oh, you don't know which one it is. There it is. Is that one there? It's called Chlorophytum bakeri. Bakeri. Chlorophytum bakeri. I'm pretty sure that's what it is. How I got Tracheandrus spicatus, well, that's anyone's guess. Chlorophytum bakeri. I'd love to know if the botanists on the internet, on the Twitterverse, are perhaps... maybe you agree with me, maybe you don't. But we're going to go around here, and then we're going to sort of head gently up towards the dam at Arethusa and see what's there. I don't think there's any water in it yet, is there, Gendry? Are you aware? You don't know? Just turning the radio up slightly. Doesn't seem to be anything of great import here. There is a dog sighting on the go, unfortunately, on Hoffman's, which is over there, and that's a reserve that we can't go to. A wild dog sighting, I mean. So they are back and they're around, and with any luck they'll come on to Juma or perhaps Arethusa again sometime fairly soon. Chandry, there is a steinbuck. It is lying like a stein. Can you see it lying like a stein, Chandry? You don't know where it is, do you? It's because your eyes aren't young like mine. They're old. They've seen too many terrible things in their time. There it is. That Steinbuck thinks that we can't see it. But we can, Steinbuck. Yes, even if you put your ears down like that. There's an impala, top right-hand corner. It's quite nice to see. Looks like a young male. I don't think it's adult yet. You can see his little horns. See him putting his ears back? That's very clever, of course, because the ears of a steinbuck are one of its most obvious features. He will be extremely relieved for the rain that we've had and the flush of forbs of different sort of aromatic plants, very energy-rich, some of them quite... sort of filled with oil, I suppose, as well. But I think his digestion copes with those. He needs a lot of energy to survive. See him panting a bit there. She's still quite hot. And they lose heat through their noses rather than through their mouth, or oral panting, if you like. Those ears are just astounding, aren't they? Very nice. Now, everyone, how old do you think those impala are? I love this time of the year, well, for many, many reasons. But one, because it's great to point out the different ages of the impala. Those impala, I don't know if you managed to see their horns properly. Let's go a little bit forward and see. Andre, my young eyes are failing to see them. There they are. Hello, Darlene. Well, we just see if we can't see those impala there. No, that's a female. She doesn't have any horns. Anyway, they're 2-year-old impala, everyone. And their horns have just sort of curled round, and during the course of the next year, they'll open out into the adult impala horns, and then from then on, it'll be almost impossible to tell how old they are. Darlene, you want to know why we don't pick wild flowers? Darlene, simply because there aren't that many of them around, and so what we try and do is to not pick them and leave them to breed and seed themselves in the ground. They're also largely annual plants, which means if they haven't produced their seeds yet and you pull them out, they're never going to grow again. They won't grow from their roots or the little bit of root that you leave there. So that's why we don't pick them all the time. I mean, sometimes we pick very common ones. If there's a whole field of them, then we might pick a few. But not just because. Hello, Jean. You're wondering what the chocolate-scented flowers are. I think you're talking about, is it Heterozygia pretorius? I don't think it's, or Pretoriae, it doesn't have a common name. I think that's the one you mean. I know exactly the smell you mean, and I think those are the plants, Heterozygia, or Heterozygia, something like that. I think that's the answer. Now here are some impala males, but you see they've got to the stage where it's not possible to tell their ages. We'll just ease past them. See how the horns have opened out now? Now they won't really change shape for the rest of that impala's life. So that's over 2 years. Well, he's at least three. He's three plus. How do we know three plus? Well, of course, they've all just had their birthdays, most of them. That's very nice galloping there, Gendre, isn't it? Yes, wonderful. On we go. I've got it wrong. It's Hemizygia. Hemizygia. I think it's Hemizygia. I've got it wrong. It's something like that. I know exactly the plant you mean. I'll figure it out as we drive. Okay, it's huge. It's sitting on that tree there. I don't know what it is. Ooh. What is that, everybody? What do you think that is? Let me get my binoculars out. Chandri, what do you think that is?
A bit juvenile or rather
ruffled. It looks a bit juvenile, a bit rough and stuff.
All ruffled.
Does rather, doesn't it? But I think there's a giveaway here, everybody. The giveaway is the dark outer wings. And I think Gendry is correct. It is juvenile, but I think it is almost certainly a tawny eagle. You see that lapwing behind me agrees completely. It just said, yes, yes, tawny eagle. Let's see if we can get it slightly closer to it. Always interested when you see a tawny eagle or a battalier sitting in a tree that there might be something dead around. They like to eat carcasses. Oh, there he goes. Well spotted, Gendry. That's fantastic. She was. Good job, man. Good job. Now let's go with Tawny Eagle before we get another look and have to change and embarrass ourselves. We'll call him a Tawny Eagle. I'm pretty sure that's what he was. Now, of course, we have to trespass here by about 10 meters. 10 meters area. Woo! Whee! There we go. Roger, you apparently agree that that was a tawny eagle. Wonderful news. And I think we are now going to link to Byron because we have slightly unstable signal. See you shortly.
All right, I've just arrived at the nest where the hardy-dar is. Let's see if there's anything up there. The adult is there, it appears. Yeah. Let's see if we can see the chicks. I'm just going to do this a little bit, just to shed a bit of light over there. Might just help us. Let's see if we get any movement from the chicks. So I wonder if they're just not resting at the moment. Let's just give it a few minutes. Let's be patient. We might see them. At least the adult is on the nest. Maybe it's not feeding time. Come on, where are the little ones? It's amazing how they can hide. That nest doesn't look very deep at all. I think I can see a bit of movement there with the head. Well, grumpy old man, you did want to come back to the nest and see the chicks. Let's just be patient and hopefully they do stick their heads out for us. Now, Lucy, you want to know, do the chicks have to compete with one another? There we go. There's a little bit of a tuft underneath the female. It looks like she was sitting on top of them, maybe keeping them warm. And you asked, Lucy, you asked, do they have to compete with one another for food? Yes, I'm sure there would be a lot of sibling rivalry and competing for food. Now I can see there are a few little feathers blowing in the breeze just underneath that female. I wonder if I don't try reverse a little bit. Let's just try change this angle an inch or two. Oh dear, hang on. Maybe through there, Brian. Let's have a look through there, maybe. Yeah, you can see a bit of the movement under that female. Lucy, just getting back to your question. Yeah, there will indeed be a bit of competition, and there the chicks are. There we go. We will indeed, they will definitely compete for food. I don't know to what extent, though. I don't know if they kill one another like some of the other bird species. Ground hornbill is one example. Usually two or three eggs are laid, and then the one who hatches first, who's big and stronger, will kill the others. There we go. They're the little chicks. Well, not so little, actually. I'm trying to see quickly while we're sitting out. I'm just reading. Grumpy old man, you want to know if the male helps raise the chicks? I'm not sure. As I was saying before, this is the first time I've ever seen a hardy-dar nest with chicks in it. I'm actually trying to read up as we speak and see what happens. Or try to get some info for you quickly. Hatching synchronous or over a period of up to 5 days. So they try and hatch around the same time. A clutch of about 3 eggs. So 27 days from the start of the nest building to hatching of the first egg. That's interesting. 29 days to hatching of the other 2 eggs. Eggshells drop all black. Let's just see. And a grumpy old man. Both adults do brood and look after the chicks. So the male and female will come back and regurgitate food for the chicks. So that is very, very interesting. That's wonderful. And then, very, very interesting. Nice. Helps having that little app. It's got so much information on it. While we move away from these birds, it's getting dark now. We're not going to see them too well anymore, but at least we got to see them. Let's head back to James, who's got some other birds to show us.
We've been having a very funny time here, everybody. There is a woodland kingfisher. You can see that it's just had its evening bath. Now he's cleaning his teeth, sharpening his beak. And I've been trying desperately to try and take a picture of him as he flies down and swoops into the water. I have failed to get anything other than a blurry shot of the water surface. This is not surprising, of course. As you all know, I am the world's slowest photographer. So that is the kingfisher. Let's just sit on him. There's a few other things. Ooh, Jandre, of course, is not slow at all. Jandre, that was exceptional work there. That's your one compliment for the month. Now, please don't do anything else exceptional, otherwise I'll be forced to say nothing. That was quite impressive, wasn't it? Now, of course, many people would then assume that this bird was eating fish. It is not eating fish. It is just having a bath. Isn't that cute? Oh, I think that's wonderful. Let's see if he does it again. There are a few other things on this tree. There. See, he thinks he's laughing at Jandre now. See if he goes again. Red-billed buffalo weavers there are here. We'll show them to you now. Also, some foam-nest frog nests, which we'll show you as well. But let's just see. Wait once more, Jandre. Let's see if he goes. Oh. He might just go and show us the foam-nest frog nests himself. There are 2 just above the kingfisher's head. There they are. Right underneath the red-billed buffalo weaver's nest. Now the foam nest frog, just in case you're a new viewer or you've forgotten, because we hardly saw any of them last year at all, made by the grey tree frog or foam nest frog. And that there is the sort of culmination, if you like, of an extremely vigorous mating affair, where the female produces some sort of pheromone that drives all of the male frogs absolutely wild with desire, and they go up and find her, and there's a great bun fight over who gets to mate with her. And while the bun fight is happening, there's such a scrum, and they're all producing this sort of, I guess it's a slime at that stage, but the slime gets whipped into a froth, and into that froth go the frog's eggs and the sperm from the male frogs, and the fertilization, I think, actually takes place inside that sort of foamy nest, and then it hardens in the sun, and the tadpoles are incubated inside there, or the eggs are incubated then, and then when they hatch, they eat their way out of the foam and drop down into the water, where they eventually become other foam nest frogs after that quite astounding process called metamorphosis, where something that looks like a fish becomes something that looks like a frog. Then we'll just see if we can't show you some red-billed buffalo weavers. Thank you, Mia Mycat. You say, well done, Jandre, on getting the kingfisher flight. I have to confess that I agree with you, Mia Mycat. It was very impressive. They are very scruffy nest builders, or the red-billed buffalo weavers. It's like a sort of colony in there. Each couple's got its own little section, and each couple breeds. But it really does look deeply uncomfortable. I would be scandalized if I'd been born instead of into the soft crib into which I was placed in my first weeks, into a thorny mass of real acacia thorns. This kingfisher's back. Let's have one last look at him, and then we'll move on. He's, yeah, you got him there. And then we'll carry on. I'm not sure how long our signal will last. I think it'll be absolutely fine, though. So once we've had one last look here, we will move on. There he is, just drying off in the wind. Perhaps he's got a date this evening. Do you think he's got a date this evening? I'm sure that's why he's getting himself so spruced. There he is. He's going to pick her up now. That's her house there. I think she's over there in that bush over there. Now, apparently we can't move just yet because Baron is going through a bad signal area, but there is a terrapin over there. You can just see his head sticking out there. Gail, you're wondering what body of water this is. Gail, this is the Pacific Ocean. We're on the shores of the Pacific Ocean here. You can see it's quite calm at the moment, but very nice to be here on the coast of the Pacific Ocean. I'm obviously talking complete nonsense, Gail. This is a little pan on the airstrip. I think it's called, interestingly enough, Airstrip Pan at Arethusa. I don't know if you remember, but we had tea, or Scott had tea once with the late Gracie over here, and that was just in a sort of air traffic control tower over there. So that's where we are now, Gail. Rebecca, do you think I might chance a little movement forward? I'm pretty sure we'll be okay, or do you want me to stay here? Okay. Byron is in a good signal area now, so let's go across to him. I'm pretty sure that he will have something interesting to tell you.
Look what I've just spotted, everyone. A little scrub hare, just trying to hide from us. Very close to the road. Hello there. That is wonderful. Not often you get to see one during the day. They're very secretive and they do hide in the thickets when the scrub, hence the name scrub hare. That's interesting. Is that a big tick on its back? Oh, that's hectic. It does look like a big tick on the back of that scrub hare. So even these little creatures do get ticks, especially these little rabbits. It's not a rabbit. Especially these little hares. I can't believe I just said that. It's a hare, it's not a rabbit. Even these little hares who live in thickets, obviously they would pick up quite a few ticks and fleas. Now, I made a joke about rabbits and hares, but the difference is, now, the rabbits, and this is quite interesting, but so two main differences between rabbits and hares. So the hares, like this scrub hare over here, live out in thickets and in scrub. And also when they give birth to the young, they are born precocial, which means they are able to move around very soon after birth, just like a good example would be the impala lambs. Very soon after birth, they're able to stand up, walk around, eyes open, ears covered in fur, and they can move around and keep up with the females. Same with the scrub hares. The young are born precocial. However, rabbits, they live in holes in the ground, in warrens, and also when they give birth to young which are altricial, which means completely helpless, blind, hairless, and they rely completely on the adults to survive. Another example of animals like that would be leopard or lion cubs. When they are born, they are altricial, completely helpless. So that's the two main differences between scrub hares or hares and rabbits. Wonderful. That's a very nice surprise. And there it just darts off. There we go. All right, let's see what else we can find. It's starting to get darker. Almost time for the spotlights to come out. Let's see what we can find this afternoon. I mean this evening. Maybe a chameleon, who knows? It has been warm the last few days. And we have had rain not too long ago, so maybe the combination of moisture and heat brings out some more reptiles. We saw that black mamba this morning, so the snakes are definitely around, so no reason why chameleons shouldn't be. Now I'm approaching a little dam. Let's see if there's anything that's possibly around here. No. Let's have a look here quickly. No, completely quiet. But actually a lovely scene with a beautiful skyline. Beautiful silhouette of that dead tree. It is a beautiful afternoon, lovely afternoon. We've seen some very interesting things today. We've been very fortunate today. This afternoon has been very successful. No elephant though, unfortunately. I don't know, the elephants are all hiding. Can hear some of the birds giving their last calls for the afternoon or early evening. Grey go-away birds calling ahead of us. There's a red-chested cuckoo calling. I'm actually going to go and investigate and just have a look where those grey go-away birds are. And if they've seen anything, you never know. Just worth having a look. Start shining the spotlight a little bit. Let's see what we can find. It's that awkward light I've always referred to. It's not quite dark enough for the spotlight just yet. It's here, and you know what those grey go away birds could possibly spot an owl in a tree. Let me investigate. While we do that, let's head to James, who has some antelope he'd like to show you.
It looks like a donkey more than an antelope, of course, but that is because it is a baby waterbuck. Isn't he sweet? He's just hidden himself behind a little bushel there. In order to stay away from our prying eyes. His mum's just there too. I'm saying he, but I don't really know what sex he is. It's impossible at this stage of the game to tell. Isn't he sweet? Already the tick's bothering him, and I think he was probably born... Ooh, I don't know, what should we say about... I think very recently, I think probably in the last 2 weeks or so, this little fellow was born. And what's interesting about them is that they don't seem to be particularly seasonal. Yes, of course, they have a birthing peak, and that's probably round about now, but we've seen these things born all year round. And they are waterbuck, in case you're wondering. Sorry, I didn't even say that. If you happen to be a new viewer, you're looking at this thing, and as far as you're aware now, we're looking at a donkey. It is, in fact, a waterbuck. And they're just walking off behind us now. Into the fading light, Jean-Ray, the fading light of the 6th of December 2016. Gorgeous. Except for that power line. Anyway, the reason that power line's there, everyone, is because we're at Aretusa. And we're just about to go over the dam wall, and that power line feeds Aretusa with electricity and indeed allows their guests to have air conditioning and blow dry their hair when they need to and have ice in their cocktails in the night. Very important to have ice in your cocktails, Jean-André. Yes. Marcy, you say you think that waterbuck looks really big for 2 weeks old. Well, Marcy, you may well be right. It might be older than that. I'm not sure how much older, though. Perhaps you could tell us how old you think it was. Not a drop of water in here. Just the remains of a rotting buffalo. And really not much else. There's some impala and nyala the other side. Oh, AC, you're wondering about what a waterbuck baby is called, a lamb or a calf. AC, a waterbuck baby is called a calf. Anything above the size of a nyala, so that's a nyala, anything above the size of a nyala, or nyala sized actually, we have bull for the male, female cow, and baby is calf. And then for anything smaller, like those impala just behind there, we've got ram for the male, ewe for the female, and lamb for the babies. So duyke, steenbok, impala, bushbuck, all are lambs. Nyala, kudu, wildebeest, waterbuck, all are calves. And that is Vernon's house. He is the general manager. Very nice. On we go. I wonder if Vernon knows that he was live while he was in the shower. We won't tell him. Right, Byron apparently has an update for you. Let's go and find out what it is. I'm going to start heading towards Juma and back towards home.
So Spotlight is out now, having a good look around. And just seeing if we can't find a Lumpfan, which is, I believe it's Shangaan for chameleon. Let us see. And maybe a Shepamu, which is a scorpion. James would probably correct me on my pronunciation. That's all right. What was that? It looked like a cuckoo of sorts. It just flew past. Very quick view of one. Feels like it's actually quite warm, warmer than it was earlier. Or is it just my imagination? I'm not sure. Anyway, it's so hard to spot these little creatures at night. I mean, I sometimes think, okay, I know what to look for and I'll possibly find one, but it doesn't work that way. It's very difficult. David from Napa, you wanted to know if one of the chicks in the Haridar nest could be that of a cuckoo, perhaps. Now, for those of you who don't know, the cuckoos are brood parasites. So what they do is they lay their eggs in other birds' nests, and the other birds actually raise the chicks. Only one egg in a nest, so it will mix and mingle with the other chicks in the nest, and then that host bird will raise them. But no, David, it will not be a cuckoo in the Haridar nest. Those chicks are far too big, and I think the eggs are also too big, so the Haridar would most likely recognize that it is not one of the its own eggs. Haridar is a bit too big for a cuckoo to try and use as a brood parasite. Okay, come on, we need to find something. I'm looking very carefully for a scorpion now, that would be great. And we should get them out tonight, surely. There's no wind, it's perfect conditions for not just the scorpion, but chameleons too. You can hear cicadas calling close by. This is quite difficult, I won't lie. Very, very difficult. Oh, big bird just took off out of the tree. I couldn't see what it was. Perhaps a Wahlberg's eagle that was potentially trying to roost in that tree for the night. Maybe just move to another one. So, I think this might be a good opportunity, not really to say goodbye for the evening, but just a bit of a farewell for the festive season from my side. I'm leaving tomorrow. So to all our viewers, and thank you very much for a wonderful 3 weeks. Hope you've all enjoyed it. And I hope you all have a wonderful festive season, whatever you might be celebrating, and have a fantastic new year. And I will definitely see you in the new year, though, sometime in January, hopefully. But yeah, it's been wonderful, always great and always fun on Safari Live. I hope you've enjoyed it too. Hang on, there's a car coming and I need to work out how the lights work and the spotlights. Let me just move off to the side here quickly. But we will try our best to find some nocturnal animals. Good evening, everyone. Hello. Good, good.
Where are my dad? He's sitting in the
Hoffman. I don't know. We didn't see anything.
The guy is checking by my dad.
Really?
Between Hoffman and the guy.
All right. Well, good luck.
You have cool modern globe here. Globe is right.
Really?
Yeah, you want to get a big Tesco.
Maybe we'll see him. Let's see. Let's see if I've got some luck. Enjoy, everyone. Bye. So they said they saw a big elephant bull not far from us on Zoe's Road. Why don't we go and have a quick little look and see if we can find him. It is dark, but we might still be able to get a view of him just before we run out of time. Changes things slightly. It would be wonderful to end off with a big elephant bull. Uh, James, I have no idea. Good question. You wanted to know how many nests can a cuckoo successfully parasitize in a season? I don't know. I'm not sure. I'll have to double check for you. I don't know how many eggs they're able to lay in a season. I would guess it's probably only maximum two or three. I don't know. I don't think more than that. But I'm really not sure, so I'll have to try find out for you. I don't know how many nests or how many eggs cuckoos lay in a season. Maybe some of our viewers might be able to have a look for us and see if they can find out. But I don't know. My guess would be around two or three, but I'm not sure. Where is the rather large elephant they spoke about? All right, well, James is back on Juma. Let's get an update from him, and I'll keep a lookout for this elephant.
Yes, we are back on Juma, everybody, and that, I'm afraid, is the sole update that I can give you. We saw nothing further on Arethusa, but we're now back here, heading towards the clearings of Quarantine eventually, in order to see what has popped out there. I'm afraid I miscalculated my timings horribly, and so we haven't made it back to the lions, but we'll try and find them again tomorrow and see if they perhaps have recovered those two little cubs of theirs. I do so hope they have, and I hope that, well, as was pointed out to us today, one of them must be a male if they are found. Because all of the four that were there today, just females. Now, if you have just joined us, I'm just quickly going to tell you the story of the Nkuhumas. They were frightened off or killed today at Bivilsuk Dam. They ran away, disappeared onto Juma, but two of the cubs, for some unknown reason, stayed at the kill. Perhaps they were just hungry. And it's very strange that it took a long time for the lioness to go back and look for them. She went back to look for them as basically we got, or as we went live, she started walking back towards the dam to the kill site. They killed a buffalo yesterday sometime. And she kind of walked up to the buffalo, looked at it perfunctorily, chased off a few vultures which then went into the trees. The vultures had very clearly been there all day long. There was vulture dung all over the carcass. And then she just turned around without calling, without making any kind of indication that she wanted to find the cubs, and walked back to the rest of the pride, where she lay down and, well, it was five lionesses and four cubs. So very strange. And we just hope that they will get up sometime during this sort of time of the day, when it gets a bit darker, head back to that carcass site and see what they can find. I don't know, it's very odd. I don't know that anyone else went to them this afternoon, so I'm really not sure what's been there and what hasn't. Anyway, I haven't heard anything on the radio. Now, we too are hoping for chameleons, not impala. Impala is not good at this time of the day. Go away, impala. Oh well. And I shall just shine the light gently from side to side, scanning the bushes for the shiny fluorescent glow of the flat-necked chameleon. Or the glow of a leopard's eyes, perhaps. That would be very nice. Also strange, of course, I think interesting, that Hosanna and Karula have absconded, sort of, away from Shongile. Hosanna spent 2 days on his own recently. Now Shongile is spending more time on her own, and I think that that's not unusual, and I think that it is an indication that the young princess is perhaps starting to think about moving on from home. It's, I suppose, a little bit like a, let's say, 17 or 18-year-old girl, and she's starting to sort of take her first steps of independence, got her driver's license. She's probably moved into a flat in the garden rather than away from home completely. And I think that's the stage that Hosanna's in, at least Shongile's in. Hosanna, of course, is still enjoying the fruits of home, and while he likes to be alone sometimes, he likes to get at the family bread bin, take leftovers out of the fridge and demand that his mother buys him a meal every so often. And I think that's rather like an 18-year-old boy, really. Certainly that was the case when I was 18. It's not very different now that I'm 40. Hello, Darren. You're at the University of Pretoria and you're doing engineering. Well, our, believe it or not, our technician Connor is an engineer from the University of Pretoria. You say that thank you for the drives. They're helping you through this exam period. Well, I hope that your exams are going very well indeed. And of course, you're a science student, as was I, and I bet all the commerce and sociology and art students have long finished their exams while you still sitting there going through the horrible motions of your exam. So good luck with them. And I do sympathize. I don't wish to be back doing that for any money in the world. So good luck with your exams. And I am glad that our safaris are helping you through. All right, everyone, that's going to be it from Jandri and James. Jandri and James. Thank you, Jandri, for your efforts today.
Yes,
well done. Excellent. Okay, that's going to be it from us. We'll see you tomorrow. I just thought I should pause there for comedic effect again. I'm going to do it again. And we'll see you tomorrow at 0500. Bye-bye.
So we have not had any luck, not with an elephant or a chameleon. well, that's the way it goes sometimes. We haven't had much luck with chameleons this season so far. But maybe it's still a bit early. Also haven't seen any scorpions just yet. And thank you very much, everyone. We're saying they hope I have a wonderful holiday. Thank you. I hope everyone else does too. Wherever you might be going, travel safely. As I said, it's really been wonderful. I hope you've all enjoyed it. But one more bird call, James Richard. You want to have one more bird call? What shall we do?
The Hardy Dog.
The Hardy Dog.
Yeah.
No, wait. Grey-headed bushrike. I might end with a leopard call, but thank you very much, everyone, from myself and Brian on camera. Thank you.